It's a showdown for a shot at a championship. The number 4-ranked Queens Gaels are riding the strong arm of quarterback Danny Brannigan. The second-ranked passer in CIS history threw for 515 yards and 5 touchdowns, leading his team to the 2009 Yates Cup victory. One more victory is needed on the road to the Panier Cup, the number one team in the nation. The defending champion Laval Rouge et Or won their 7th straight Dunsmore Cup last week, with the help of last year's Heck Crichton winner, Benoit Gruel. Will the Gaels be golden, or will Laval get to their second straight Vanier Cup? Stay tuned. The Mitchell Bowl is next.
Spring-like conditions, but a definite playoff football feel is in the air here in Kingston as the host Queens Gaels set to tackle the Laval Rouge et Or in the 2009 Mitchell Bowl as CIS football returns to the airwaves here on TSN. Hi Canada, I'm Claude Fague. Welcome to Richardson Stadium and the hometown Gaels hosting their first Mitchell Bowl game in 26 years for that football factory known as the Laval Rouge et Or. The defending Vanier Cup champs want to get back home and defend their title on home turf next week. Now speaking of home turf, as we send it to our play-by-play crew of Rod Smith and Mike Morreale, got a feeling one of the two may have a story or two to tell about their playing days here in Kingston. Fellas.
All right, thank you, Claude. I'm afraid my playing days here are so long ago, I've forgotten most of the stories now. I'll be getting stories from this guy. Welcome. We are so pleased to have CIS football back here on TSN and very pleased to be joined by Mike Morreale. We all know about the CFL career. What you may not know, he had some stellar years at McMaster as well.
Well, first of all, thanks very much. It's a pleasure for me to be here and join the crew. Yeah, my years at Mac were great. Never got to a bowl game. It's going to be a great game here today.
It is a special moment. I got to two of these, but never won. Laval is so used to winning. 5 Vanier Cup titles over the last 10 years, and they're on the verge of getting back again. Just one win away. 7-1 regular season, 3-1 on the road. That one loss this year was to a Montreal Carabin. They avenged that loss last week at the Dunsmore Cup easily, 31-7, and they are led by their stellar quarterback, Benoit Gruel.
And he's had an outstanding career so far. 5th-year senior, 3 times the Heck Crichton nominee last year, won the award. He's taken this team to Vanier Cups year after year. 11th all-time in passing yards. That's not the important thing to him. It's bringing this cup and the opportunity to win it back home to Laval next week.
Queen's University has a great reputation in football as well, but it has been a while since their last championship. They haven't played in a national semifinal since 1992, and they won the Vanier that year. But a 7-1 regular season, first place in the OUA, 6-0 at home. They beat McMaster in the playoffs, and then in a dramatic game against the Western Mustangs. So little between these two, Queens won the Yates Cup for the first time since 1978. They're led by their quarterback, Danny Brannigan.
And what an outstanding season he's had. An amazing game last week, throwing for over 500 yards in the Yates Cup. 2nd all-time to Michael Faubs in career passing yardage. He has a lot to prove. Wanted to get the Yates Cup under his belt, looking for the Mitchell Bowl today, and then Vanier next week.
So Queens looking for its first trip to the Vanier since 1992. Laval is the defending Vanier Cup champion, but this year is special for them because for the first time, Laval will host the big game. The road to get home for Laval goes through Kingston at the Mitchell Bowl. Claude?
And so the players take the field, the bands are playing, the fans are ready as we set for the 2009 Mitchell Bowl kickoff, and that's next on TSN.
CIS football on TSN is brought to you in part by Desjardins. The largest cooperative financial group in Canada is proud to support Canadian inter-university sport. By Mitsubishi Motors, makers of the best-backed cars in the world. By Wilson, the only football on the field for all of the CFL and CIS teams. Wilson, number one in football. And by BlackBerry. Get the best phones on the best network, like the BlackBerry Bold 9700 Global Smartphone from Bell.
It's a doubleheader of CIS football. 2 national semifinals today beginning here in Kingston with the Laval Rouge et Or and the Queens Golden Gaels. I know they call them Gaels now, just Gaels, but that's a tough one to get used to now for me, having been here a while ago. Beautiful day for football, 9 Celsius, slight breeze, and the field, which was in question earlier this week with some rain, looks to be in pretty decent shape. We get set for this Mitchell Bowl. Laval and the head coach Glenn Constantine, what a remarkable success story he has been. 4 of Laval's Vanier Cup titles have come with him as the head coach. Stellar record, as you can see, in his 9th season. And an old friend, Pat Sheehan,
who used to be a head coach at Concordia and goes even further back with Glenn Constantine. Knew him at a much earlier age in his 10th season as Queens, and finally getting to a national semifinal. He's been there before with Concordia. In fact, went to the Vanier Cup in 1998 and lost a very close game to the Saskatchewan Huskies. Queens is to kick off. Laval, on the right of your screen, will receive, and it is Dan Village, number two, to get this Mitchell Bowl started for Queens. A good crowd again here at Richardson Stadium to see the start of the 2009 Mitchell Bowl. And the Laval return now, Guillaume Rioux, who is met at the 30-yard line. And that is where Benoit Groulx, the Heck Crichton Trophy winner in 2008, will go to work, a nominee once again. He's got some talent to work with, Mike.
He certainly does. You look at the receiving corps. Fioli Gudino leads the way. Third-year player, two-time conference all-star MVP of last year's Vanier Cup. And David Bouchard, fifth-year senior, top lineman in the Quebec Conference.
It's a pro-style offense, Laval runs out of shotgun and throwing right away and greeted right away at the 30-yard line. Rio on the receiving end, Chris Smith, the linebacker with the tackle.
You know, they're looking to Shamari Williams to lead the way like he did last week. Defensive lineman had a huge game playing beside Ukwoma. Follow that up by T.J. Leeper in the linebacking core, Russ Jackson nominee, and Jimmy Allen, the fifth-year cornerback, and the punt and kick returner.
Second down and five for Laval. Discussion going on at the line of scrimmage there, but that's great defense. The great ends for Queens and Shamari Williams and Ukwoma.
Yeah, Ukwoma and Shamari Williams are top-notch. Leaper in the middle. DePrado and Smith come up big, too. They have set next year, or next talent ability, and Jimmy Allen on the corner. Watch out for him, the fifth-year player.
Not sure what the discussion is about, but they get it off now, and looking deeper now for Mathieu Picard, and it is thrown a bit too far by Gruel down to the Queens 35, so Laval will be punting. Two and out, so a good start for the Queens defense, something they talked a lot about yesterday, getting ready for this game.
Yeah, take a look at the left-hand side of your screen. Gruel drops back, looking for Picard running the corner route. He's well open by 5 or 6 yards. He just can't connect, but they're going to try and take advantage of those matchups in the secondary.
So it is Christopher Milo, number 19 Laval, standing back to punt. He was injured last week, rolled his ankle against Montreal. Jimmy Allen, one of the return men, back for Queens. He's had three returns for touchdowns, three punt returns this year, leading the nation. And that one rolls, and it is Mark Surya taking it. Waiting, tries to get the no yards, and he does, just outside his 25, so penalty Laval there. So a little better field position for Danny Brannigan and the Queens offense to go to work.
And Brannigan has a lot of help, especially on the receiving core. Talented receivers across the board, led by number 82, Scott Valberg, who led the nation 2 years in a row. And then on the offensive line, you're looking at big Matt O'Donnell, 6'11", 318 pounds in his third year.
Old lines have changed a lot since I played. You look at the list here. O'Donnell, 6'11", 318. The smallest on the line, Dechavita, is 287. And then Dan Biederman, 327. Jonathan Coitus, 325. Derek Morris, 322. That is a load up front. No sacks at all by Western last week in the Yates Cup against Queens, as Brannigan handing off right away. It's Marty Gordon, the ball carrier for Queens, and a good gain on first down.
And you look at Laval in the top defense in the country, led by that big defensive front four, Boudouin Cloutier in his fourth year, conference all-star the last 2 years. Kelly Hillier on the linebacking core as well in his fifth year, and another conference all-star. And at halfback, Maxime Berube, fourth year, conference all-star, CIS All-Canadian. It sounds like the who's who of the all-stars and all-Canadians back there for Laval.
After a 6-yard gain, Laval was penalized as well, as Glenn Constantine wants an explanation of that, but it goes up to first down. an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty going against Laval. So first down across midfield is the Queens offense on their first drive of this 2009 Mitchell Bowl. A scoreless tie just underway. Glad you could be joining us here from Kingston on TSN. Out of the shotgun and handing off. And a gain of 3 or 4 yards once again for Marty Gordon.
You know, for those people who haven't seen Danny Brannigan play, he's a different style quarterback. He's certainly your prototypical sit in the pocket and wait, but he sits in the pocket like no one else. Doesn't move his feet a lot, doesn't throw by attacking the football. He has such great arm strength. He uses that to throw from sideline to sideline.
Gain of 3 by Gordon, 2nd and 7. Brannigan working out a shotgun, standing near midfield, handing it off again. Gordon again taking it, not quite first down yardage. They get down inside the Laval 45. It'll be closed within about a yard.
Yeah, if they can keep up this running against the Laval defense, and Marty Gordon taking the handoff here, going right up the gut. Some nice blocking up front by the big boys. O'Donnell and the crew leading the way. Good positive gain. Shane looks like he's trouting out the punt team with over almost 2 yards to go.
So the offenses feeling their way through. Dominant offenses, two of the best in the country. Western number one. Laval was number two. Queens number four overall in the country. Dan Village standing at his 51 to punt it away. And a low, not a very good punt. Just down to about the 35. Queens trying to avoid no yards there, and a short return by Guillaume Rieu up around the 30. You're watching the 2009 Mitchell Bowl on TSN. Back in Kingston, a meeting of two great quarterbacks in their fifth year. That is Benoit Grue of Laval. Has already won the Vanier Cup twice and last year's Heck Crichton Trophy winner.
It's like the grocery list of what to do when you play university football as a quarterback. Throwing for over 1,462 yards this year. Unbelievably, 73.2% completion rate.
That's the most telling thing about his numbers, because he doesn't often play a complete game. That's why he doesn't have passing yards. You'd see from Brannigan or Michael Falls at Western. They often pull him if the lead of the game is in hand at halftime. Out of shotgun and handing off. And short gain there. Queens doing a good job of stuffing the run there. That's the big back Sebastian Levesque on the carry, a gain of only 1 yard, 2nd and 9.
And the Gales definitely have a great defensive front four. Miniachi, McDonald, Ukwoma, and Shamari Williams. And they do a good job inside here attacking that offensive line. Get to the running back, Levesque. Leaper wrapping him up around the legs. And it's a key to this game, stopping that run game.
Levesque was 5th in the nation in rushing yardage with 874 in the regular season, 2nd and long. And passing, Rue trying to set his footing. Has a man, and it is caught for first down yardage for Laval. That is Maxime Mellon for Laval, and they're across midfield into Queens territory.
And you take a look at the route running here. It's 5 hooks across the board. This one goes to the right-hand side of your screen. Mellon makes the catch, comes back to the football quite nicely, attacking that coverage. Just couldn't get there in time to make the tackle, but a nice catch and a nice developed play.
Maxime Mellon, his second year from Newville, Quebec, and a 16-yard gain, first down, and Laval's second possession. In Queens territory, here is Levesque. Gets outside. Some hard running there for 4 or 5 yards inside the Queens 50.
And Levesque has had an outstanding season as well, in a huge playoff run the last couple games. And they need something big out of him today. Everybody knows Rule's going to throw the football down the field with some accuracy. They complement it with Levesque in the background, in the backfield, and churning out those yards. Makes it a lot easier for that offense to run.
In his second year out of Richelieu, Quebec. Buster, he's tough. Give him a bit of daylight, and he's got some speed. Just a three-man rush for Queens. Lots of time for Gruel, and they get him. Sacked by Shamari Williams, and Laval will be punting.
You know, this comes down to a coverage sack by the defensive backfield. They did a great job getting on top of their receivers, not letting anybody get behind them, not leaving too much open space. Shamari Williams comes up big with the tackle at the end, and he hustles right-hand side of your screen. He's working against the offensive line for Laval. He keeps fighting all the way down the line.
This guy has next level playing capabilities.
I've seen at least one CFL scout in the stands today, asked him who he was watching, and happened to mention the name of number 33 in gold. Not the only one, but you can be sure CFL teams are paying attention to. Shamari Williams, the punt. Taken down by Surya at his 10. Finds some room on the right side, and Surya gets it up across the 30-yard line for Queens' next possession. Danny Brannigan and company getting set to go to work. It's the Mitchell Bowl on TSN. Rod Smith, Mike Morreale, Claude Feig back in Kingston. Danny Brannigan and the Queens offense are getting set for their second set of downs. Only three men in the history of the CIS have passed for more than 10,000 yards, Mike. Danny Brannigan and Michael Faulds became two of them on the very same day.
You know, and Brannigan only ended up less than 100 yards short of the all-time lead. Actually missed a game and a half this year due to a concussion he suffered against McMaster in the regular season. Got something to prove today, though, with this big game.
Second to Michael Faulds all time, but doing something today Faulds dearly wishes he could do. Western losing on this field last week, and the Yates come passing there and taking a pop, too, is Devin Sheehan, the son of head coach Pat Sheehan. That one a bit too far by Brannigan, second down.
You know, what you'll see a lot today and what's happened all season, the protection that Danny Brannigan gets from his offensive line here. Look at the time he has, a step up in the pocket. Really doesn't get touched till after the throw. Sheehan running up. They like to run this seam route. Nobody touches him. Talked to Coach Constantine before the game. He said, we got to rough up these receivers a little bit to get them off their routes. That time there, he ran free. Almost had a shot at making the completion.
And it was the man delivering the hit, Jonathan Laliberte of Laval, who is being escorted off the field now. A little hurt. You consider not only the passing yards of Faulds and Brannigan, to see them in the same game twice in a month. And last week, a game you were at, they racked up over 1,000 yards combined passing.
Yeah, it really was a game for the ages at football at any level. And they put on a show, and Brannigan came out on top.
Remarkable quarterback. Lots of time again. And he finally moves out of the pocket, and it is intercepted. Went in and out of the hands of a Queens receiver. And it is Laval's number 14, Maxime Berube, taking it. So in scoring position is Laval on the first turnover of the game.
And in any game, of course, you want to limit the amount of turnovers, certainly in your own end. This time, Brannigan again gets a lot of time. Ioannidis in the backfield, number 86, leaks out to the left, runs a flat route. The ball gets delivered to him. It literally goes through his hands. Maxime Bedard makes a big play, brings it across the field, eventually gets tackled for a limited gain, but sets them up on the Queens' 26-yard line. And just an errant play by Ioannidis, who sure-handed most of the year.
The first big break of the game, it goes to Laval. Ball down around the 25 of Queens. First down, Grew. What a shotgun again. Looks inside and over the middle, deflected and intercepted right back. No. They say no. It looked like he was picked, but it touched the ground, and so Laval keeps the ball.
This is a great job by the Queens defense, jumping the football. You'll see number 20, Vickers, in your backfield. He's going to read the play and make a jump on the ball. Great reading of the route running. Watch the deep in route. Vickers through the receiver, tips it away, and Leeper very, very close to making that interception.
TJ Leeper nearly had it. Instead, second down. Pressure. Down he goes again. The second sack of the day for Shamari Williams.
You know, we talked about Shamari last week for a long time. We'll get a chance to see what he does here, and does it with speed. Right-hand side of the screen. Keep an eye on Shamari Williams and what he does. Little inside rip move. Gets by the lineman, gets by the running back. Puts Gruel on his back. That's a big key to what they can do. A little play action and not enough time for Gruel to set up. Shamari Williams using that inside rip move, getting to the backfield.
So a field goal attempt now, easily within the range for Christopher Melo. He's hit as far as 44. This one 40 yards away. It has the distance, and it is good. So put the first points on the board now. Or Laval Rouge Or with that 40-yard field goal. It's a 3-0 game. And Christopher Melo, who injured his ankle last week, seems to be fine. What are they playing for? Well, Queens is playing Laval for a trip to Laval. That's where it is at Stade de Peps next week. First time ever that the CIS Football Championship will be played in Quebec City. You can watch it on TSN, part of Grey Cup Saturday. Great day for football on Saturday and, of course, Sunday with the Grey Cup. Watch it all on TSN next week. So starting at the 35, Brannigan on the out, and that is high and tended for Sheehan.
Well, that time there, Brannigan seemed to just hurry his pass a little bit, got away from him, a little bit of a high ball to the outside. But he still is getting that protection. He's very comfortable in the pocket all year long. You know, last week playing against a great Western football team, never got sacked, and that certainly helps give your quarterback time to make some completions downfield.
Queens trailing, three to the right, second down, lots of time, steps out of the pocket, dumps it over the middle, and once again, that is too far for Sheehan, and so the Gales, two and out, will be punting.
Well, Brannigan falls short that time as he heads to the sideline, and take another look at that offensive line and that pocket they set up for Brannigan. He's got collapses just a bit on him, not so much by the pressure, but DeSavitas drops back a little far. He's going for Sheehan on the little over route and just to the outside.
0 for 4 and intercepted. Not the kind of start Danny Brannigan has been used to this season. Lots of pressure on the punt by Village. Taken by Ryu right at the 45. That's where Laval will scrimmage. Now with a 3-0 lead at the Mitchell Bowl. Back at Richardson Stadium in Kingston, it's the Mitchell Bowl, the first quarter. Laval with the ball and a 3-0 lead after a 40-yard field goal by Christopher Melo. For a big battle of quarterbacks, it has not been that stellar for either, especially Danny Brannigan has yet to complete a pass. Good defense so far in this game on the toss. It is Levesque. Breaks one tackle. It's still short yardage. Queens' run defense has been very solid, Mike, so far today.
We'll take a look at what Levesque does. Nice hard runner over the backfield. And watch Shamari Williams again. He gets the pressure that he wants. Smith takes it from the outside, pushes it back inside, and everybody comes up to make a tackle. Vickers, the one taking him out at the knees to wrap up a hard runner like Levesque.
Second and long for Drew. Looking deep. He wanted Bruno Prudhomme, but he is well covered, and that one falls a bit far, so a two and out for Laval.
And you look at the kind of defense that Queens is running here, it almost turns into a cover four look. You got four defenders in the backfield. That time the cornerbacks are running with their receivers, and you got the two safeties playing deep. They don't want to give up the deep ball here, as Gruel hasn't been able to connect on the deep ball yet today.
Melo standing back inside his 35 to punt again. It's been a good defensive game so far. Neither offense has really been able to take much command. Laval had a chance down near Queen's red zone, ended up with the field goal. That was it. All the scoring we've had so far. A low driving punt taken by Jimmy Allen down at his 15. Up across the 30. For Brannigan, still looking for his first completed pass at 0 for 4 and one interception as well, and talking to Pat Sheehan.
Well, not really indicative of the type of football he's known to be playing, batting zero right now in terms of completions, but he's definitely getting the time behind the pocket. It seems like he's just a bit wound up. First big conference bowl game, and the jitters might be getting to him.
Most of those passes have gone higher, too far, a little bit too much on them. Handing off on first down. Some tough yardage there. And still on his feet is Jimmy Terrien. Looked like they had him, and he just kept going. He kept chugging. The whistle didn't blow, so he gets a first down.
You know, they like to platoon Jimmy Terrien and Marty Gordon, and this is why. It's a little change of pace. Terrien takes the ball in the middle. Not a big guy, but never stops churning his feet, dipping underneath his own lineman upfield. And when your safety's making the tackle, that's after usually a very big game. But you see he's smaller in stature than Gordon, but never stops churning those legs. Turns into a big first down.
He had more yardage in the regular season than Gordon did. And taking the handoff again, and this time they catch him for shorter yardage. But Terrian picked up in the regular season. He was seventh in the CIS with 508 yards, averaging 5.1 a carry.
And Terrian got banged up a bit, did a hamstring a few weeks ago, and really didn't get the opportunity to finish out the regular season strong. And they've been platooning a bit, like I mentioned, with Gordon. But a healthy Terrian is a very good thing for this Queens offense.
Went to Upper Canada College. He's from Montreal. Picked up. But three more, second and seven. Brannigan standing in again. Has time! Has a completion. Good catch over the middle. Christopher Ioannidis, and the first completion for Brannigan of the day, goes for 16 yards and a first down.
And they really like to use Ioannidis. He's going to line up on the left-hand side of your screen. He settles in between a tight end and slot back on most plays. Takes a nice hit at the end, but a nicely thrown football by Brannigan over top the linebackers right into the soft spot.
Threading the needle nicely there. So Queens, for the first time in this game, on the move. First down. The 46 of Laval. They nearly got to him. He lobs it up. And coming down for the completion inside the 10 is Devin Shayen. First and goal for the Gales.
And you know, we're going to take a look at Blaze Morrison is the one who makes this pattern on the wide out to the left-hand side, the top of your screen. And really, it's just a seam route. But he has great recognition for the football, blocks the defender off, and makes a nice catch in front of Letourneau, who had good coverage. Problem is, Morrison just had better reaction to the football.
Blaze Morrison, excuse me, got my sixes and eights mixed up. A big catch. He had won a winning catch against Western in the regular season. Morrison did. Passing again, and this time it is for Shayen. And a touchdown for Queens. No, down close.
You know, it certainly looked like he got in, but once you touch the ground in CIS football, you're considered dead. The right-hand side of your screen, you'll see Shayen come over. He runs just a simple sit-down route. Very close to crossing the line. Brannigan gets the ball out early, and yeah, what happens, hits the ground, the ball doesn't extend over the line. Good call by the refs.
Very close, he was down there, so it is. Second and goal. Trying to punch it in. There's the signal, and a touchdown for the Gales. Terrier, and a big carry earlier in the drive, gets Queens on the board.
You know, Terrier did a good job getting him down to that part of the football field, and takes it the rest of the way, going to the right-hand side behind Coitus and Derek Morris. Led upfield by Corbin, the fullback, and squeezes his way through, gets the ball across the plane, and big touchdown for Queens.
So a shakier start for Brannigan, but great on that drive. A couple of big passes, the biggest one to Blaze Morrison for 36 yards to get them down close. On the board with the first touchdown of this game. Dan Village to convert. Queens answers back. It's a 7-3 game here in the first quarter.
You know, what Laval is notorious for is getting up on teams early, especially in the first quarter, and putting pressure. This is something they're not used to during the regular season. With Queens coming back, getting the lead now, they got a bit of, momentum going, and this is how it happened.
As the fans do their traditional oil thigh celebration, Jimmy Terrian, that move there is one of the key plays of this drive.
Yeah, it certainly is the play that set it off. And then good ball recognition by Blaze Morris on the outside, attacking the football, catching it at the highest point in front of Letourneau. And then the sit-down route by Sheehan almost crosses the goal line. Terrian again squeaks it through for the touchdown.
They were talking a lot about that yesterday, the defensive coordinator for Queens, Pat Tracy. I mean, it is cliche that you want to get a good start. Every team does. But in some games, it's perhaps more important than others. I don't know if it would have been as much against Western just because of all the lead changes, the way they traded. As you said, Laval tends to bully teams. They run up quickly, and then you lose your confidence. And that was an important drive for Queens.
You know, they really do. There's no doubt there's been some sleepless nights on the Queens side, the coaching staff at the very least. They bring a lot of added pressure to every defense they play.
A six-play drive covering 75 yards, taking up 3 minutes, putting seven on the board for the Gales. With the Laval return there by Ryu.
Almost looked like Village was doing a bit of a pooch kick, trying to get his coverage team down there to get a hand on the football as Rule comes out to lead this offense, and he's looking to improve his numbers so far as well.
Well, I wonder, too, given the speed game of Laval, how being on this field will affect them, because their track at Stade du Peps is impeccable. It's a great field turf, and they looked awesome there. And they could still play the game on any surface, I'm sure, but I do wonder, especially since the field gets to get sloppy, how that might affect them. Will passing and completing. Out of the backfield, catching that is Levesque, and a good gain on first down for another first near midfield.
You know, and this is where they're really dangerous, is utilizing Levesque out of the backfield. You'll see him at the right-hand side of your screen right there. He's going to leak out into the flat, and what happens is Pankowicz has to cover him. You're going to take that matchup all day long if you're Laval, getting that rookie linebacker on Levesque.
First down, midfield, play action fake. They got some pressure, and that ball goes short. Incomplete. So a second and long for Laval again.
You know, and again, right now, that defensive line and linebacking core for Queens is getting in Gruel's face and causing him a bit of problems. This time here, they get good push up front. I think it's Miniacci that gets to it at the very end, gets his hands up and makes his or forces Gruel to dump that ball off a little quicker, not to the guy he was initially going to. Falls short in front of his receiver.
A big second and long now for both teams after that Queens touchdown. The 4-point lead, they have him again. Benoit Gruel sacked for the third time today, taken down by committee at the Laval 45.
And you know what? This is all the defensive line. They did it last week against Michael Falls. They're doing it again today. Again, Miniacci's there. Duquam was there. Shamari Williams is there. At the top of your screen, Shamari Williams again, inside move against Fissette. And boy, he's just overpowering him. And he's not a big, big guy. Left-hand side of your screen, Duquam on the bottom. And right to the backfield, Shamari Williams, Miniacci there to clean him up. Rule doesn't see this often. This is a key.
The story so far in this game has been that Queens defense. Laval got three on the board thanks to a turnover. They have had a lot of trouble moving the ball so far today. And punting again as Milo stands inside his 35 to get this one away. Low driving to Surya, takes it at his 30. And runs back right into a tackle, back to the 25.
Well, you talk about that Queens defense, you look at Shamari Williams on the sidelines there, they've really stepped it up. They're certainly a force to be reckoned with in the OUA, and they want to take it to the next level in the CIS, and they're doing a heck of a job here today. You've got Miniacci on the inside, you've got McDonald on the inside, and then the two big studs, so to speak, on the outside, Ukoma and Shamari Williams, have wreaked havoc on opposing defenses all year, or offensive all year long.
Shamari Williams went to the University of Houston, worried about getting playing time there, and I think a former strength and conditioning coach here at Queens had talked to him about the idea of coming up and playing for the Gales. It's been working out well for him. And on that out, it's complete. First catch of the day for Scott Valberg. And up first down yardage at the Gales 40.
You know, and again, you're taking a look here at the leading receiver in the nation, 2 years running. Valberg here is going to run a little out route to the top of your screen. Nice patient job. And just a quick speed cut to the outside. And there's Brannigan Strength throwing on the money. Receiver, defender's got to come downhill and doesn't get there in time.
Brannigan really settling down now after the first couple of drives. Valberg, the leading receiver in the CIS in terms of catches, second in yardage at 913. And his first one there, and back to the run. Picking up a few more yards is Jimmy Therrien. This is what he did last week. Valberg against Western.
Yeah, Valberg made quite a few great catches. 8 catches in total for almost 140 yards and a couple TDs. And really what he has after the catch is speed to burn. You get this in open space to a guy like Scott Valberg, and he's going to take it to the house every time.
Scott Valberg in his fifth year, one of the veterans of this team from Bay Ridge High School here in Kingston. A number of fourth and fifth year players for the Gales. This is it for them. This is their big shot at getting to the Vanier Cup.
You look at what he's done this season. Let's not forget he did the same thing last season, leading the nation, leading the CIS in receiving. And, you know, playing with a guy like Mike Brannigan helps, but you've got to have that skill as a receiver to get it done.
There was an injured player for Queens, the right tackle, Derek Morris, out for a few plays. A second and seven after that three-yard carry by Terry. 7-3. Gales with the lead. Out of shotgun. Brannigan again. That one goes a bit too high for Sheehan. And it'll be third down.
And this time Sheehan trying to settle in that little zone in the 12-yard box. A little bit down the field in between the Sam and the Will backer on the right-hand side. Sam and the Mac backer, excuse me. And great drop by the defender. The ball's getting away on Brannigan a bit. That time a bit high also. I think he's trying to muscle it in there. Waiting to settle his feet, but Sheehan, another one of those receivers, great game last week as well.
And an interesting dynamic for the head coach who also coaches the receivers, and Pat Sheehan, his son Devin, said it's kind of like being the parent of a goaltender in hockey. They're on an island, and it's hard to ignore what's going on, but he's done a great job for that team, and no yards called there, and the Gales coverage a little too close, so a few more yards for Laval. And what's been an interesting first quarter is it is coming to an end. Zero's on the clock. A feeling out process in this championship semifinal. The first of two bowl games we're showing you here on TSN today. After one, Queens up 7-3. Getting set for the start of the second quarter here at the Mitchell Bowl in Kingston. 7-3. Queens leading Laval as you look at the first quarter stack.
Yeah, a couple telling things. 105 yard net yards led by one big play to Blaze Morrison, but the three sacks by that Queens defense really lead the way.
Stats of the quarter brought to you by Mitsubishi, proud partner of the CIS. And the quarter begins, first and 10. Laval and Benoit Gruel looking deep again. The coverage is good. No chance at all. Jimmy Allen is there. Stride for stride with the Laval receiver, Julian Fioli-Gudinho.
And you look at that protection now for Gruel. He does get a lot of time. He's got some big boys up front, Gagne, Bouchard, Breton. Nobody's touching him that time. And they must see something in there. It looks like a little stutter and go by Gudinho, but nobody bites on the outside on that play. And it's good coverage. Ben D'Andrea.
You may have noticed that they were going the same direction on that one final play, because even though there were zeros on the clock, they didn't officially call it a quarter until now for some odd reason. So now we're seeing 15 minutes on the clock again. So that, in essence, confusing as it may seem, was actually the final play of the first quarter. So I'll try this again. So to start the second quarter, it is Queens leading by a score of 7-3. I think we would have noticed they were going the same way. And he goes with a similar play. This time he's got a man wide open. Bellon, Maxime Bellon, takes it down to the three. And Laval's in business.
And you know what? This, again, gets to the protection that Gruel has to throw the football. And Bellon sneaks out of the backfield. He's right here. He does a little flat and up the sidelines. He gets lost in the coverage. Ends up going down the field. You see Smith at the end trying to chase him down. But Ballon sneaks out of the backfield to the right-hand side. Does a little flat route. Takes it up the sideline. And Chris Smith is left chasing after him.
Maxime Ballon, a 62-yard reception, the biggest play for Laval's offense today, to be sure, and boy do they need it. It's been a struggle through the first. End zone look and a touchdown for the Rouge Or. Number 80, Seydou Junior Hedera gets the touchdown for Laval, and the Rouge Or back in the lead.
Gruel does a good job here just getting out of the pocket and moving enough to let his receivers get a chance to get open. Hedera's the one that takes advantage of the opportunity as he takes the snap. A little bit of pressure, but good protection. He wants to move the pocket out to let his receiver get some room. And you see Hedera comes from the other side of the field, settles in that little pocket right in the zone, and makes a nice catch.
Hedera, the freshman receiver from Quebec, with the first touchdown for Laval, and Milo converts. So a three-point lead reestablished by Laval. And that was officially that big play, the first one of the second quarter. A good contingent coming from Quebec, making that six-hour bus trip.
You take a look at Ballon on the right-hand side. He's the tailback, comes out of the backfield, up the sidelines. Chris Smith, you can see him in chase position. He didn't see him come out there, and he was left playing catch-up. Gets right to the one-yard line or two-yard line, leaves it up to a throwing play by Gruel. Gets on the pocket enough. Madera comes from the other side and settles in the little area. Nice catch.
Quite the ball game here in the first of two. The Mitchell Bowl. Pat Sheahan sees his team take the lead, then give the lead up once again. Trailing by three. We could be in store for a beauty here. The defense has really ruled in the first quarter, but we've seen some big plays as well. Something we might expect when you have two fifth-year quarterbacks as good as Gruel and Brannigan. A staple of good receivers. They've ruled by offense all season long. Two of the top offenses in the country. Good stand by Queens defense, although that was the big play. They gave up the 62-yarder to Ballon. It's changed the momentum once again. Hey, Mike, and you've been to a lot of these Queens games this season, at least the ones against Western, momentum swings were the rule of the day.
Oh, yeah, if you're not getting five or six lead changes, this isn't a Queens football game. And really comes down to coaching. Get some great guys on either sideline that are have these teams prepared. And now it's Queens' turn to answer.
The winner of this game will take on the winner of the UTEC Bowl. We'll be showing that later today on TSN between the St. Mary's Huskies and the Calgary Dinos. And an interesting homecoming, if you will, for Blake Neal, the head coach, and Eric Glavich, the quarterback for Calgary. Both used to be with St. Mary's. That Vanier Cup on TSN will be played at Stade du Peps in Quebec City for the first time. Laval's home field. Laval is trying to get home with a victory so they can host it.
Brannigan's taking his time getting to the huddle here. The refs waiting for him, allowed him to get in, but they're in the shadow of their own goalposts now and have a lot of field to work with.
Test goes back to Brannigan after an impressive drive the last time Queens had the ball, starting on his 15 out of shotgun. Standing in as he always does, looking for Surya, and it's timed perfectly as he takes it, and he's still on the move up across the 40. First down, Gale.
And you know what? You have to talk about the arm strength of Danny Brannigan. I saw the play develop from up here, and Surya was open, but it wasn't by a long shot. LeJoy had a chance to come down and make a play, but the arm strength of Danny Brannigan, look, doesn't even step into it, just using the arm and the shoulder. And Surya does a nice job coming back to the football, dipping underneath the tackle and getting some extra yardage.
Another half second maybe with that Laval corner. LeJoy closing in. Over the middle, complete again. Brannigan's got this offense moving up near midfield. Catch there by Devin Sheahan, another first down.
And Devin Sheahan here settling into that zone again. This time Laval's defense drops and looks like a cover four look. Right-hand side of your screen, you'll see Sheahan sit down as the number two receiver, finds a soft spot, sits down, actually sits himself down there. The field is going to play some, wreak some havoc on a few players today.
On television, it still looks to be in pretty good shape, but they have had some rain, and won't be surprised if it starts to look a little more chewed up later on. As you can tell, it's been kind of slick. And Sheahan happy with the catch, a little unhappy that he went down so soon on his own. Over the middle again, Valberg's got it. Scott Valberg, a third straight first down in that Queens passing game.
And you have to like the route running, but you also have to like just the confidence that Brannigan throws this football with. Valberg has a deep in route, and look at Brannigan sitting in. He times it up perfectly, throws the ball high and away, so Laval couldn't get to it, and a nice, pretty play and pretty catch by Valberg, the leading receiver in the nation.
And another big gain, a gain of 19. Brannigan's offensive line, back in his earlier days, his early years, used to get frustrated that he ran out of the pocket so much. He learned that lesson. Rarely gets sacked despite standing in on the move there, and a nice catch down at the sideline. That's Devin Sheahan reaching up, and a flag goes down.
Wait to see. It's probably going to be a push off against Sheahan coming back to the football. He's going to bring this back, and when there's contact with the receiver and the receiver extends his hands, he's going to get called. You can use what's called the flipper and get the kind of the shoulder and the forearm into you. But if you extend it a bit to push off and come back, you're going to get caught.
So it looked like an offside call. Against Queens, it does come back. Nonetheless, it's his first and 15. Setting up the screen, and it's read nearly perfectly by Laval's number 44, Jean-Michel Fortin. Nearly had an interception there. Laval had one by another El Fortin, Marc-Antoine, last week against Montreal, where he read the screen perfectly, went right into his hands.
And this is a nice job by Fortin. He's going to read, he's going to attack the line of scrimmage first and then drop off when he sees screen, drop right back into the throwing lane, but just almost make a nice play on the football. If it wasn't for Sheehan, that could have been a pick going the other way.
Second and 15, Queens. Laval 36, stepping up. Throwing for first down yardage again. Brannigan. This time to Christopher Ioannidis. The Gales still on the move. An impressive drive inside the 20. Yeah. And is it coming back again?
Oh, you like to hope not, because you're looking at Chris Ioannidis right here, lining up this time at number two receiver to the field and just settling down nicely over the football. And you know what, he's a huge target, and it looks like this one is definitely coming back.
A holding call against the Gales. So first, there was a completion, a first down catch negated by an offside, and now one negated by a holding call. So they're now 25 yards away from a first down. It is second and 25, pushed back near midfield now. Brannigan needing a lot, gets a bit. No, he doesn't. That falls incomplete out of the hands of Sheehan. So from what looked like sure scoring position for Queens, they will now be punting.
Yeah, a couple big penalties there on catches backed up Queens, and now they forced a punt, but the offside by Sheehan and then the holding call against the offensive line for Queens took away some big pass completions that would have moved him into Laval territory.
Emotionally, as you go to the sideline, if you're an offensive player, how do you feel about that drive? Obviously, you're not happy, and yet there was some encouraging signs.
Yeah, I think you're happy you're moving the football against the, you know, the number one defense in the country, but at the same time, you got to look at yourself and not take it that hard.
The punt there by Village, and no choice at all for the return man for Laval, Julien Fioli-Godinho, to step out of bounds. Laval ball here at the Mitchell Bowl in the second quarter. Back in Kingston, Laval leads Queens 10-7 in the second quarter of the Mitchell Bowl. And now it is time for the question of the game, brought to you by BlackBerry. And this is a very interesting question. Let's see how much you know football. What is Queens QB Justin Chaplin's connection to Laval? Justin Chaplin, the backup quarterback to Danny Bryan, has a connection to Laval. We will answer for you later on. See if you can take a stab at that. It is interesting, to say the least. Laval handing off. And it is Levesque with a big gain. Had a nice big hole up the middle on that first down. Gets another one. That'll move the sticks up across the 25.
You know, if you're the defense for Queens, you got to be worried about quite a few things. One is number one pass, because Gruel does it better than just about anyone. But look at the left-hand side of your offensive line here. They're creating some huge space, led by Gagne, the center. Big crease for Levesque right up the middle.
You can see the slick conditions, too, of this field at Richardson. Matt Vickers had a line in Levesque and slipped and fell, leading to more yardage and some tough yardage there up across the 30 for Laval. And Levesque, the ball carrier once again.
Well, Levesque shows his strength there, too, his leg strength. A couple of chances for some leg tackles and arm tackles, but it's just not going to bring down a guy like Levesque. And they're going to try and establish a run to the best of their ability and then go to that deep ball and try and make some big plays when they can.
Gain of three, close to 4 yards, call it four, second and six. Laval, last drive, thanks to a 62-yard completion to Maxime Delon, led to a touchdown there, first of the game, and the lead again. And Rue is really starting to get it going as well. The man who scored the touchdown, Hedera, on the receiving end there for another Laval first down.
Yeah, and what they're setting up here is the wide receiver screen to the right-hand side of the TV set. Comes back underneath, Hedera does, from the wide out position, led by a couple blockers here is going to come right at you. Makes the catch, cuts underneath a couple of receivers and leading O-linemen, and there's some big boys led by Gagne leading the way.
Seydou Junior Pedera. Another good, solid run. This is the kind of running that Levesque is used to in the Quebec Conference, averaging 9.3 yards a carry in the regular season. Gets close to 9 yards there for Laval.
You know, he really had a fantastic regular season, but look at what he's done postseason with the numbers he did against Concordia, 266 yards, and then in the final against Montreal, 120 yards and three touchdowns combined between both of the games. Big numbers in the playoffs.
Part of a 63-1 rout in the first round of the playoffs by the Battle of Concordia. But that time, Levesque takes it. He had nine before. He just needed about one and a half, and he did not get it. It is third and short, and an interesting decision coming up here for Glenn Constantine and Laval.
Now, Miniacci's had himself a good game, number 98, playing inside some of the nose tackle position on defense. He's really forced his way upfield. That time there, he gets inside position, and right off Fissette again, who's struggled a bit with Shamari Williams. This time, Miniacci getting underneath and making a nice stick in the backfield.
Constantine quickly put the punt unit out at this stage of the game. Makes sense. In their territory, just outside the 45. Milo standing at about his 32 to punt it away. Queen stuffed the run when they had to. After some good gains by Levesque. A low, short punt by Milo. Surya waits it out to get the no yards, and he does draw it. And then heads out about the Queen's 45, so at the penalty yardage, good field position for the Gales and Danny Brannigan to work with. They have the ball when we come back at Richardson Stadium. The good crowd out here on a nice November day for football, watching the Queen's Golden Gales, I'm always tempted to call them. They call them the Gales now only, but trailing 10-7. Against the Laval Rouge et Or here midway through the second quarter, Queens football. Brannigan out of shotgun. Tries the out. Had a receiver. It's Surya, who can't hang on. Second down.
Yeah, it was a nicely thrown football to Surya. He does a speed cut out to the right-hand side of your stream, and Brannigan just nicely thrown football right through the hands. Got to make those plays today especially.
Tough going back to your quarterback if you drop one?
Oh, he's a very reserved guy. I think give you the benefit of the doubt, but just be prepared to catch the next one coming your way.
I was asking you. You never dropped one, though, did you?
All
A deep ball, close, and he wants the call. He doesn't get it. That's Devin Sheehan. There was contact just as the ball was arriving, and as a result, it went a little bit far, and you can tell which team the crowd is cheering for. It looked like interference here, Mike.
They have a reason to be upset. Letourneau at the end, that little grab there doesn't look like much, but just enough that that last step he couldn't take to get the arms out to touch it, that was about as close as you're going to get to, you know, hopefully getting a flag. And that seam route again run by Shea, and they're trying to hit that.
So Queens punts after that incompletion. It is dropped momentarily by Guillaume Rieu. He picks it up, and he gets some decent yardage up across the 35 for Laval's offense. Great weekend of football. We've got the two CIS games today. We have, of course, the East-West Final in the Canadian Football League coming up tomorrow. It begins with the Lions, the crossover team, after knocking off Hamilton, taking on the Alouettes in Montreal, followed by the Western Final, the Stampeders and the Rough Riders. First Western Final in Regina since 1976. You can watch them both right here on TSN, and later today, the other CIS game, the UTEC Bowl, Halifax, St. Mary's, and Calgary. So a great weekend to watch football here on TSN.
So Coach Shane's looking for a bit of an explanation here on that last play that the flag wasn't called. And what I've noticed today from both teams is a lot of people that have heard the lore of Laval and how good they've been. And it's been a long time. They've been winning records and winning championships. And we'll watch this play again by Shane. It does a little stutter and go. And at the very end, the turnover comes from the cornerback. That subtle little pull. We don't get it because you get the back side of it, but it's enough to pull his hips away from the football. And really, that's why he picked it up the ball.
Benoit Grew and Laval have a shotgun and handing off to Levesque. Outside, pulls his way to another first down. Gain of 10 yards for Sebastian Levesque.
And I'm always intrigued and happy to see the receivers work in the left-hand side of the screen. High snap goes right to Levesque. And then you have your receivers working upfield. Picard's there, Godino's there, and trying to get turn on a few more yards and enough to make a first down for Laval.
Only 5'10", 205 in his second year from Richelieu. And he sometimes runs bigger than that. His legs get chopping once he gets some room. And takes it again. Levesque looking for more. Has a lot more. 6-7 yards up near midfield. Second and short, Laval.
That time, Fissett pulls from his right tackle position in the backfield to create a seam and a little crease for Levesque. And he's going to take full advantage of it. Looks like a 6-yard gain on first down, and this is the opportunity now for Gruel to sit back in the pocket. Second and four is a nice place to be in if you're a quarterback.
Laval, known for its vaunted passing attack, more success in the second quarter running the football. The passing now, and pressure coming and completing it. It's Matthew Picard. And he came back a bit. I don't know if they'll mark it for a first down. It will be close, depending on the spot here.
You know what? He's going to lose out on at least a yard where he caught the football. He did come back. It looked like he was pushed back a bit. I think that spot probably should have been upwards a little bit. Probably still short of the first down marker as Newell throws it to Picard here. And right where he catches it, that forward momentum should have probably put it up. Very close.
Little surprised by the spot of the ball. It goes further back. It leaves him about 2 yards shy, actually, so not even close. Nilo will be punting again, standing at his 40. Queens defense bending a little bit more this quarter, but not breaking that time. And a good job against Laval again. Another low driving punt and right out of bounds. No chance for a return for Queens there. That one marked just about the 20-yard line.
You know, maybe we should talk a bit about the field position or field condition. And we kind of mentioned it gets a bit sloppy. We've seen some players slip and slide. And it's really the team that has the football that has the advantage. Receivers know where they're running. They can make their cuts and breaks because they know where they're going to end up. You know, return teams know where they're going with the football. The defensive side of the ball gets a little more difficult because you're reactive.
Danny Brannigan from Assumption Secondary School in Burlington, Ontario. His final year at Queens. And handing off. Short yardage there for Jimmy Terrien.
You can really see that defensive line and linebacking crew for Laval stepping up on that play. Trying to shut down that run game and leave Danny Brannigan in a second and long passing situation this time here. About 7 yards, a long six to go. Still very manageable, especially when you have the second all-time leading passer in the country at the helm.
Over 10,700 yards passing. And a second and six, Queens. In their own zone, over the middle, complete. Shea, first down, Gales up across the 45.
Assume that you're taught how to run, but what you have inside in your head is the ability to read what's going on around you and see it before it happens, to read defenses. Right now we're going to take a look at Shane, the number two receiver on the inside. He's going to go up the field and find the opening. Inside release, and that's the defender get away from him. That time it's Berube, one of their top defenders. He wants to fight to the outside road. Leave Shane open on the inside.
Another shotgun and handing off. Tough sledding there. For Jimmy Terrien carrying again up near the 50 of the Gales. Father and son, Devin Sheehan, the head coach, Pat Sheehan.
asking him yesterday, he mentioned the goaltending analogy, but it's a difficult thing, too, with the whole dynamic. You don't want to show any favoritism. People look for it. You also don't want to come down too hard on him when he does good things. And he had high praise for him, but you could tell high praise as
a
player.
It was reserved a bit. Yeah, sure. You don't want to be too out there, but he certainly earned his stripes.
And he had a big catch early in that game last week in the Yates Cup. And a catch here, this time it's Blaze Morrison, and knocked outside, and first down yardage by the looks of things. The sticks should be moving again as this drive continues for Queens.
Yeah, Letourneau playing the cornerback position here for Laval. It's given a lot of space. Maybe not understanding the arm strength of Brannigan. It's going to be the right-hand side of your screen is Blaine Morrison coming back on a little comeback route, just sitting outside. And you know what? It looks like a long throw, but when you have that strength behind the center throwing the football, it gets there in a hurry.
Nice, close Mitchell Bowl. 4:06 on the clock until halftime. Queens trailing by 7. And a play fake. And airing it deep, and the coverage is there, and this time Sheehan does get the flag on the coverage by Olivier Turcotte-Letourneau. Last time with these same two, Queens complained that the call wasn't made. This time it was.
And you know what? I'm not too sure, Rod, whether that was a call on Letourneau or on the halfback in the inside against Sheehan. They had two receivers running seam routes down the field, and Brannigan likes to throw that as the referees get together to chat about it. It's going to be contact. But you're watching Valberg on the inside of Blaze Morrison there. There's contact on both. I think that call right now is going to go against Laval, against Super and all. It could have gone either way. There's a lot of hand fighting going on.
So either way, it is against Laval. And it's a 10-yard penalty on that interference. And pushes things to the 37 now. And a first and 10 for Queens. Jimmy Therrien, a first down and more. Still going and chugging down to the 20.
Well, that's a fantastic run, and we're going to take a look at the left-hand side of this offensive line. It's DeSavitas and Biederman leading the way, and look at the hole that's created. The rest of it's left to Therrien upfield, and Syria gets into the action, not after a big game, but that line for Queens doesn't let too many defenders touch the quarterback and has opened up some big holes for both Gordon and Terry and downfield.
And for all the talk about the passing games, Mike, and it's been good on both sides, at times we've seen some good running here by both Levac and Terry, who has the ball again, up first down. It's inside the 15, gets down to the 12. It'll be second and short for the Gales. They're pressing now with a little over 3 minutes to go into the half.
And we talked about the O-line, and we're doing it for a reason. You got DeSavita and Biederman on the left-hand side. He's going to be on the right-hand side of your screen now. Watch 410 on the right-hand side here. Watch the move that gets made on him by Terry. Right on the inside. Nice little cutback route. And good run. You got to look at that O-line. A lot of talk this week and the whole year has been about the O-line for Laval, and rightfully so. They're very good, but boy, this offensive line for Queens have come to play football today.
They've got size. They're definitely bigger than the Laval defensive front, which is also very talented. A player down right now for Laval. Looks to be 99 Philippe Lemire, I believe.
Take a look here at what happens on the play and where the injury occurs. A bit of a wash in the middle there. And Bernier.
89.
Bernier comes to the ground. He gets twisted up, and when bodies are flailing all around, anything can happen on any given play. Looks like he's going to get up under his own strength, and a good sign for Laval as he walks back to the bench.
Jean-Alexandre Bernier, Pierre Fonquebec, 6'3", 300-pounder. Heading off now at a critical point in this game. With Queens trailing by 3, 3:09 on the clock until halftime, and pressing deep in Laval territory.
And Rod, you really have to like how this game is shaping up and how evenly matched these teams are. There really is a little bit of tic-tac-toe going on and ball moving up and down the field.
Queens is used to this kind of game. Laval, for the most part, is not. They have dominated, with the exception of Montreal, every team this year, and they dominated Montreal last week, avenging that one loss they had. Brannigan to the side. It's complete, down to about the six. As the three-minute warning comes out now, Queens trailing, but in position to at least tie the game, maybe more, when we come back at Richardson Stadium. Here in Kingston, late in the first half at the Mitchell Bowl, Queens trails Laval 10-7. It is first and goal after the reception by Blaise Morrison at the 7-yard line of Laval.
And the Queens fans here aren't happy with us taking the timeout. It's a 3-minute warning. What can we do? And they want to start, didn't want to put a halt to this little drive that Queens had going.
Adds to the tension now for Queens fans. Can they get in? Christopher Ioannidis on the receiving end there inside the five. Second and goal.
Ioannidis going to line up almost as a tight end here on the line of scrimmage. You're going to come close on the right-hand side of your screen. Leak out as a tight slot back on a flat route. And good rally by the Laval defenders to come up. The ball pops loose. Whistle was gone, calling it dead as the forward progress was stopped.
Gets it down just outside the 2-yard line, second and goal. Big units out. Two cracks at it for a touchdown. Put them in the lead again. Play fake, passing for the touchdown. Ioannidis. And the Gales go back in front.
You know, this really helps when you have a big 6'4", 260-pound or 240-pound guy playing receiver. He's going to line up right here as a tight end, and then he's going to leak out. Pardon me, I circled the wrong guy. He actually came out of the backfield this time. The way that Coach Shane uses Ioannidis, it allows him to move around. Sometimes lines up a tight end. Sometimes he goes out at slot. This time comes out of the backfield. And a nice play, the 6'4", 234-pounder. Into the end zone.
From Birchmount Collegiate in Toronto, Christopher Ioannidis in his fourth year. And a big catch for the Gales to put them in front with the conversion, leading by four once again. Laval scored first, then a lead change with Queens going up 7-3. Laval coming back, and now our third lead change so far.
There's a fake hand off the backfield to Tarian, and Ioannidis getting a big body in front of Letourneau, and you know what? That's a big man coming down with a catch.
Nine plays, 90 yards, just over 4 minutes. Eaten up on that drive, 2:11 on the clock.
And we'll get another shot here to see the touchdown play. We keep coming back out of it. But it was lineup out of the backfield where Ioannidis came out, and you know they're going to throw some wrinkles at this Laval defense and move some people around and get them thinking, get them into coverages they're not used to, and some matchups where you got a smaller cornerback in Letourneau covering a big receiver in Ioannidis.
When they last trailed, Laval answered back shortly after with a big play, a 62-yard pass, and Benoit Gruel took it in. Got a good game going here in Kingston on the return. Guillaume Rioux gets it up to the 27.
I think we'll take another look at this touchdown. It's in the backfield. There's Ioannidis there. Right off the ball. And you know what happens? Letourneau comes from the middle of the pack. He's got Ioannidis, but he's lined up kind of playing a Mac linebacker position. He's got to fight through the whole wash of players coming in front of him. He's never going to catch Ioannidis. He gets right to the flat in a hurry. Brannigan delivers a nice ball, and now it's Gruel's turn to return the favor.
Trailing by four is Laval. Just over 2 minutes to go until they hit in the dressing room. Short pass picked up. Guillaume Rioux written hard out after a gain of 5 or 6 yards.
You're going to see Rioux come across underneath, get four receivers running seam routes, and Rioux's going to come from the right-hand side of your screen, run a little underneath the linebackers. The ball gets to him early. He's got some good speed to turn it up, a nice chase. by Smith and DiPrato as they come and chase him down.
Gain of four, second and six. Just under 2 minutes to go until halftime. Lots of time, steps up, and the coverage is there, but he threads the needle and completes it to Mathieu Picard, a first down Laval up at the 43.
It's a nice catch from Picard, but really gets down to the protection and the time that Gruel had to make this play happen, and sets back in the pocket. They got a three-man rush on by Queens. They can't get to Gruel. He steps up nicely. And we'll take a look at Picard as he weaves his way in front of Rooney, who has a shot here to knock it away and just doesn't get that right hand in there quick enough.
140 and counting. First down. Looking deep. Lots of coverage down there. Chris Smith is there. Incomplete. Second down now.
We'll give another opportunity here to look at Picard, and he's going to run the seam route here as he gets in between the linebackers, and Chris Smith gives another nice little subtle nudge there, and that's all it takes to disrupt him. You see the size difference. The ball's got to come over top a big guy like Chris Smith, and Gruel's had some trouble hitting that deep ball.
.133. Second down, 10 to go. Sacked again. For the fourth time today.
What a play by that defensive lineman. You know, we're having a newcomer here today making a play, getting in here and lining up at the top of the screen here. And it's going to be Mathieu Kendrick getting in the backfield and doing a good job just blowing by that offensive line. That time it's Bouchard, who's a great lineman.
And actually wearing 34 now, Mike, we're just told, is Osei Okwuma, who is normally number 91 and started the game with that number. And I believe he did anyway. He is wearing 34. We're wondering who this great 34 lineman was.
I apologize. I was struggling to see who that was. And well, there you go.
So Osei Okwuma, yes, an all-star end with Queens, had a great season, and switching numbers on us and making a big play. Yet another sack of Benoit Gruel today. So they have to punt it away, 1:10, and rolling out. So the clock stops there at the Queens 36. They have the four-point lead, and they may not be done yet before they call it a half. Looking to add to that lead, they'll see what they can do with Brannigan coming back on.
Well, you know, that makes sense, Rod, as you and I are struggling to see who the heck is moving forward. On our list, it's John Matheson, a running back, who said, I don't think he's lined up at defensive end. And,
for running back, yeah, he plays pretty good defense, too.
I was going to say, nice throw in, but it is Osei Okwuma, who's had a heck of a season. Switching from number 91 to 34, so we'll keep an eye on that.
And at 6'3", 260, the Brandon Jacobs type, wouldn't he? He was running the ball. Lots of time. My goodness, Brannigan has all kinds of time and dumps it off complete. And a little bit more there for Marty Gordon, taking that one in a first down.
You know, Marty Gordon's going to sneak out of the backfield and settle in the soft spot on the sidelines. And really, it's protection again by that offensive line. It's got Biederman, Kuitas, and Derek Morris on the right-hand side. And really allowing Brannigan a lot of time to make nice throws with timing, coming back to his second, third, and fourth options.
The clock continues to tick, now under 50 seconds, down to 45. Queens up at their 47. They would need a couple of big passes here to get into field goal range. They work the out to stop the clock. That is a Devin Sheehan, or Blaze Morrison, excuse me, on the receiving end there.
You know, it's Super Noel on the tackle, but you got to think that they're really hanging back on these receivers for Queens and allowing Brannigan to throw the ball downfield and gain 7, 8, 9 yards a pop. That time there, it's a gain of 7, but they're playing off those receivers quite a bit, and they have to test them.
Dan Village, very accurate kicker, only missed one in the regular season, combined with the playoffs, 15 for 18, longest 47. So they're getting closer to his range now with 32 seconds on. They probably need about 10 more yards and they'd have a good shot at it. And a first down for Queens just inside the Laval 45.
They're going to go to the hurry-up offense and take advantage of the clock. Now down to 32 seconds, get right to the line of scrimmage.
Five more yards, and that would get to the distance that Village has hit from this season. Gordon. And they get that and some. So they're within his range now with 23 seconds and the clock stop. Down inside the 40 to about the 37, 38-yard line.
Once this ball gets set, they're going to wave in the clock and again going to the hurry-up offense with 23 seconds left.
See if they can get closer. Valberg has it, stays in bounds, trying to get out of bounds now, and he does. So it stops with 13 seconds, down at around the 35. Be looking at about a 42-yarder for Dan Village.
Take a look at the left-hand side of your screen. You're going to see Valbert come across on the under route again, but nice coverage from Super Renault, who keeps him in bounds at the end of the play. I think by the referee's call, he called him in. And we'll find out right now when it gets whistled in by the referee. And no, he was ruled out of bounds, so that clock won't start until the snap of the football.
So one more play before they could bring Village out. I'm sure Branningham will just be trying to give him a few more yards. Obviously passing. Looking at the out. Five more. Definitely in his range now, down to the close to the 30, I believe, where they'll spot it. So you're looking at about a 37-yard try for Village with 8.9 seconds to go until halftime.
And realistically, you have another shot here to try and go for it, maybe go to the end zone. That Coach Shane calls his timeout, so the clock won't run until the snap of the football. And why not take the chance if you can? He's well within Village's range as it is right now. The only other thing you may see is a run play to set up the ball where Village likes to kick it. Most kickers, you know, depending on what footed they are, like to kick from either hash or the middle of the field. So you may see that as well.
So it is a first down, and the ball is on the Laval 30. Queens up four, and a great chance now putting three more on the board.
One thing about CIS football, you do get two timeouts in a half, so there is an opportunity to go for it, call the timeout, and get Village set up properly.
So Brannigan still going out again. Village remains on the sideline, just awaiting his turn as they will play with that essentially 9 seconds left and run one more play. For Valberg down at the 5, but no, it falls incomplete. So Village will come out and try a 37-yard field goal to see if he can put the Gales up by a touchdown at the half.
Yeah, they tried a nice timing route to Valberg on the outside. Wasn't in the end zone. Kind of a little confused as to why they threw a pass pattern but didn't try and go for the whole thing, unless they wanted to get really close for Village. Nonetheless, as an attempt right now to put it through the uprights and basically extend this lead by a converted touchdown going to half.
Missed only one attempt in the regular season, 12 for 13, and has kicked one 10 yards longer than this. Down it goes, up it goes by Village, and it's good. And that's the end of the first half, where the lead has changed three times. And Queens has added to that lead now, up by 7 on the 37-yard Dan Village field goal.
That's a nice kick to end off the half. Jimmy Allen's the holder. Nice hold. Laces out. That splits the upright. Village with a nice kick and now up by 7. And I'd like to find out when the last time that Laval was down by 7 at half.
Pat Sheehan's team has the lead heading into the half. Here he is now with Claude Fay. Claude?
Yes, indeed, Pat Shane. What a great way to start for your team here at home. all the crowd behind you. It's got to be a plus to have this kind of momentum and the lead going into the half.
That's been a great football game so far. The atmosphere is electric, and boy, Queens really showed up today.
And with all the talk about Danny Brannigan and the offense, your defense has stepped up big, and you've kept Benoit Gruel in check.
Well, we had the one explosion play there. We got to keep those to a minimum. They're a very explosive team. They got a lot of speed and a lot of talent, so we got to battle them for the next 30 minutes.
Thank you, Pat.
Thank you.
Queens has the lead. 17-10 here at the Mitchell Bowl, 30 minutes away, possibly advancing to the Vanier Cup.
And welcome back to Richardson Stadium in Kingston for the 2009 Mitchell Bowl. Queens on top of Laval, 17-10 at halftime. And that's the trophy they're playing for, the Mitchell Bowl, that was renamed in 2002 after the gentleman that is standing right beside me right now. And here he is, Doug Mitchell. Doug, welcome to your game.
Yeah, thank you very much. Actually, it's been a great game. Queens has played exceptionally well. I think they've been seen as a long shot, but I think they've really dominated the first half.
It's got to be exciting. Obviously, you have your name on the trophy, but the whole premise of college football, Canadian football, you were involved in it. You still are involved. You were a CFL commissioner here. I know this is near and dear to your heart.
Well, very much so. You know, I think athletics is such an important part of a university education, and sometimes I wish that everybody at the universities, including administration, would feel the same way. But you look at this crowd at Queens today, I think it's terrific. There to be got a lot of credit, not only the students, but the administration for the crowd here. And it's been great. The weather's terrific. And I know in the CFL, we feel it's so important, the university football programs bringing up and developing Canadians for us.
And I know a university like Kingston, they're playing for this trophy for the first time in 26 years. It's good to see new blood. We know what Laval can do, but it's always good to see new teams, old teams kind of recycle, get back into it.
Well, it's kind of interesting, you know, because the big four from the east, like Queens and University of Western Ontario and Toronto, used to have a hard time, but I think it's great. When you think of the development of football in the province of Quebec over the last few years, I mean, it's been absolutely and totally changed the whole dimension of football in Quebec and at universities. So, no, it's great, and I think it's wonderful that college football has grown so much since I was involved in it years ago.
And, of course, the great thing is there's a lot of talk about expansion, maybe another team to Quebec, maybe Ottawa finally getting a team back. So instead of talking about attrition in the CFL, we're actually talking about expansion again.
No, that is terrific, and I feel very much that the focus of the Canadian Football League is very much on football rather than issues that we've had in the past, and I think Ottawa is no doubt potential, and it would be great if something in Quebec City, because there's such a great rivalry between Quebec City and Montreal.
All right, Doug, thank you very much for your time. Really appreciate it.
No pleasure. Thank you.
There he is, Doug Mitchell, the name of this year's tournament, the Mitchell Bowl, and at halftime, it's Laval trailing Queens 17-10. We're back at Richardson Stadium in Kingston. After this,
a great crowd watching a great game so far here in Kingston. The Mitchell Bowl with Queens, the home side, leading number one Laval 17-10. And for all the talk, Mike, about the offenses, and they are great, and the quarterbacks, and they are great, I think maybe the biggest story so far has been the defense of the Gales.
No, it really has, and they needed to come up big today in this biggest game of the year for them, and they certainly have. And you look at some of these plays here, Gruel doesn't have a lot of time at all. Shamari Williams and company, Miniachi, McDonald, and Ossie Okwuma, who later on changed his number to 34. We're going to keep an eye on him. They've been putting pressure on Gruel all game long and really getting out of the rhythm he's accustomed to.
Laval is certainly capable of coming back. They've been the top team this year overall, but they're getting a bigger challenge than they're used to right now. Queens is used to the back and forth play. I'm sure more of it is to come in the second half of the Mitchell Bowl. We're just getting started here in Kingston. Back after this.
Welcome back to Richardson Stadium in Kingston. Laval trailing Kingston's Queens University 17-10. Ray Glenn Constantine, Obviously, very intimidating kind of an environment here with the home team and the home crowd. What was the message to your team at the half?
We're going to start making plays, tighten up coverages, no penalties, and we're going to make some plays on our self-sustained drives and make some stops on defense. So we got to make a couple of adjustments. Hopefully things work out.
And Benoit Gruel, obviously all eyes are him and Dan Brannigan. The defense doing a really good job to slow down your quarterback.
Yeah, they outstanding job by Queens. A good pressure on our quarterback, good coverages. It's a well-coached football team.
Thank you, Glenn. Appreciate it.
All right, Claude, and interesting for Laval, Mike. We talked about it before, how they've been tested. It's a great football program, but I don't know if they've been tested this season quite the way they are being so far today.
No, really, and the pressure that we talked about at halftime that Gruel's taken on offense by that vaunted defense for Queens, really. They've really stepped up the way they're playing football, and it shows.
Danny Brannigan getting warmed up as you look at the numbers, reflecting the score in that 7-point Queens lead.
Yeah, we talked about it at the beginning of the end of the first quarter. 285 yards here, but again, the four QB sacks has really thrown off Gruel on offense and hasn't allowed him to do what he normally does. And he's taken a lot of shots downfield, and really, the only one he connected on was one to Ballon that led to the score.
Each of these teams have lost this year. Laval lost on the road against the Montreal Catamount by 14 points. Queens lost at the end of the season to Laurier. Laval avenged its loss to Montreal decisively last week at Stade de Peps, winning it 31-7. So they both know what it's like to be tested, but a point we do draw upon, especially the games against Western Ontario for Queens, they're certainly used to facing adversity against that school in particular, having to come back, being down late in the game. See if it comes to that this time. You get the feeling as you look at return man Maxime Bellon. He had a big play in the first half. Getting set to start the second one underway. It's Ryu with the ball for Laval, and a flag down and a big return. It'll probably be coming back by the looks of things as he gets it up to the Laval 50.
More often than not, where the position that flag was thrown is definitely going to be holding against Laval in the gate. It was a big gain by Ryu, and put Gruel under the goalpost again to start this drive. We'll take a look at the return and where it happened on the right-hand side of your screen, or pardon me, the left-hand side of your screen. You're going to see the hold right here. It takes place. And believe it or not, you want to know who that is, Rod? That's Shamari Williams, defensive end, running downfield, playing special teams. Really, what more can you say when your starting defensive end wants to run down and kick off?
Part of the coverage and a big part of that defense in this game so far. With his two sacks in the first quarter. So set further back, Sebastian Levesque and Laval, and a short gain on first down, closing in on the 15.
And there's the guy we talked about, Shamari Williams again. He's going to come down, scoot down the line of scrimmage here. There he is lining up. He reads the play initially. Nobody's blocking him. You have to block Shamari Williams. He's going to make a play. And he did right there.
In his fourth year of eligibility out of Brampton, we mentioned before, he had some time at the University of Houston. Cougars, not getting playing time. Key part of that Queens defense in this game. Second and long for Greer. Lots of time, lots of coverage where he was going for Mathieu Picard. Three Gales defenders were around him.
And you know what? This is the strength of the defense line. This time they're only going to rush three, but they're getting pressure with three. They're dropping nine guys back, and there is people all over the place. Defenders for Queens want to knock it away. You'll see the three-man rush right now on the screen, and they get enough pressure to force him to step up and throw a ball into coverage, and there were nine defenders for Queens on top of those five receivers, and that's a tough spot to throw the football.
Laval looked like they had a good start to the half by a big kick return, but it was negated by a penalty, and then two and out. And Christopher Melo is standing at his goal line to get this away. Jimmy Allen taking it. To the Laval 45 and more. Allen, one of the finest punt returners in the nation, gets that one to the Laval 37. So already the Gales, to start this second half, are in business.
You know, we talked about the defense at length about what they've done, but really,
let's talk a bit about what Dan Brannigan did to come in and look at maybe a comparison between Gruel and Brannigan. Both started off with some struggles, but Brannigan's getting the better of Gruel right now, 17-27, 209 yards, and that one touchdown. There was the interception. The ball deflected off Ioannidis, and didn't want to have that one planned, but certainly Brannigan shaking off that rough start of a big half.
Queens has been penalized on that Allen return, pushing them back. They're still in Laval territory, just outside the 45. When you see 9 for 16 for Gruel, and any other quarterback, you might think not bad, but you pointed out the best thing about him this season is his remarkable efficiency, passing completing more than 73% of his passes. So that's a bad day for him when he's down near 50%. Brannigan passing to get Queens' second half started offensively, and it's Scott Valberg on the receiving end, close to a first down.
And again, we're looking at Valberg here, and he's knows that all these Queens receivers know how to settle in zones. Take a look at what he does right here. He's going to head upfield. He's going to settle in that soft spot. We talked about all day, a little comeback hook route. Cipriano has to come downhill, and you know what? They're giving these receivers way too much space to sit down and find the opening.
That offense is becoming more confident. And it's deflected and nearly intercepted there by Marc-Antoine. Le Fortin would have been a big play as he shakes his head in what might have been for Laval. And I was just saying that Queens offense had been looking more confident the way things went late in the half.
Yeah, Fortin does a nice job. You can't get to the quarterback, get your hands up. And right here, the top of the screen, you're going to see exactly what happens. Brannigan's looking to go. It's a second and short. He wants to get the ball off across the middle of the field early. Nice rush up the field. I think the rush was first. The first pressure that got there that actually did the tip on the football was Gilbert. And Fortin almost came up with it.
And he had an interception last week, read a screen against Montreal, dropped back. The Catamount quarterback threw it right to him like it was gift wrap. That one he would have had to work a little harder for as some pressure comes from Laval. Gets to Rioux. Guillaume Rioux on the return. Takes a pop, they wrapped him up, and they push him out of bounds, still deep in Laval territory. Field position advantage, Gales, early in the second half at Richardson. Laval ball, but Queens defense and Shamari Williams on the field, and Mike Williams has been a wrecking crew today.
Oh, he's making the most out of his first Mitchell Bowl appearance, and he just does it with speed and strength. There's something about the way he attacks the offensive line in front of him, uses the rip, uses the swim, and gets down on special teams and makes plays as well. I mean, not much more you can ask from your fourth-year guy out of Brampton, and he's come to play.
Laval, for the second time this half, with the ball starting deep in their own zone. Inside their 15, out of shotgun. Rue handing off to Levesque. Can't find it left, turns around, but still he gets caught out and taken down for no gain. Even lost yardage for Laval.
Well, let's take a look at Williams again and what he does and the pressure he brings. And this time, Laval's going to bring a receiver down to actually help out with Williams. And there's Williams there. They're going to bring the receiver down as well. Did the motion to give a little bit of help to Fissette, but it's not going to work. The penetration's there to make Levesque cut back, and then there's the pursuit by DeFrato Smith and the gang, and Williams is just being a force. And we're talking, you know, all week long about the number one defense in the country, Laval, but Queens have really come to play.
Second down, 14 to go, handing off again, surprisingly, and stuffed. Stephen Laporte with the tackle.
You know, a second-year guy, Laporte, getting a chance to play, and really, you know, he does the best he can. He's going to come from this area here, coming to the screen at the bottom. A great stick in the backfield. That's how you wrap somebody out. You look at Shamari Williams saying, that's the way to go. Everybody's got to help out and make these things happen. And Laporte, nice stick on the play.
A first-team All-Star on special teams and getting his chance in at linebacker for the Gales. Stuffing that, so two losing rushes for Laval, and punting deep in his end zone is Mila, and concedes the two. Two more on the board for the Gales, and now a 9-point lead at 19-10. So Laval will be kicking off to Queens, but a much better field position for Laval.
Well, Laval's a tried and true program. They've won a lot over the years, and especially those Vanier Cups and bowl games, but I don't think they felt the pressure like they're feeling today, and it's constant pressure. You're looking at the big defensive guys on the sideline, Shamari Williams on your left, and now what's happening is Brannigan's going to get the ball back after the safety and puts that Queens offense back on the field, and they've been playing pretty good of late as well.
Enough respect for that offense that they certainly didn't want to punt from the end zone and give Brannigan a short field. For this time, no kick. They just do scrimmage from the 35 after the safety given up by Milo, and passing for a first down right away. On the receiving end is Scott Valber.
Well, Valber leads the nation in receiving for a reason. He knows how to run routes. He definitely knows how to catch the football. He's got great concentration. Look at the timing that Brannigan has. Throwing the ball out there. Throws it back inside. Good quarterbacks throw the ball where the receiver isn't. Gives Valberg a chance to try and slip out of a tackle.
Gain of 11 up at the 46. Gales padding their lead to 9 now after the safety given up by Milo. Play action fake. Lots of time again. Brannigan a little bit high for Devin Sheehan, and it falls incomplete. Second down.
You know, and this time it's Morrison again coming from the wide out position, and he's going to come. You can just barely see him. I think he's right out there, or we'll take a chance to say that's him there, and attacks the line of scrimmage on the deep in route. The ball gets a little high and away, but ooh, definitely a catch, and he pays for it with a little chin music at the end of the play by Plusius. He comes down, and the reason he was off the line of scrimmage, they're running with a tight end set, and that allowed him to run and start.
Second and 10. Standing in Brannigan. Oh, he had Surya, who dropped one earlier, and he couldn't hang on to that one. It would have been inside the Laval 45. Instead, Village will be out to punt.
Last week, Surya had a couple drops that he probably should have caught, and, you know, he went earlier on today. You got to make this catch because Surya is going to come from this side of the screen, and what a rope he's thrown. You can't get much prettier than that. I mean, it was a nice coverage on the play. You'll see Surya on the top of the screen. Ball hits him in the hands. Good coverage. Look like a catchable ball.
From his 35, Laval is getting close on its punt rush. Rio taking it. Up across to the 36. A better place to work for Benoit Groux. Laval now trailing by 9. It's the Mitchell Bowl on TSN. NFL Sunday Night Football tomorrow from Chicago. It's the Eagles and the Bears. Tomorrow at 7:30 p.m. Eastern, TSN High Definition. Wonder if it could match the Sunday Nighter in the NFL last week with the Colts and the Patriots and the controversial Bill Belichick call. Everybody's weighed in on that. We got a great one going on here in Kingston. Laval, the better field position to work now as Gould slides a little bit with his back foot and airs it out and completes it. Had a receiver wide open and still going. Mathieu Bouvet. They're still trying to haul him down inside the Queens 30. A big play for Laval.
It's Mathieu Bouvet that comes up with the football, and really it's a corner route. He runs a lot of time. It'll happen on the right-hand side of your screen. Gould gets a lot of time in the pocket. Pardon me, the left-hand side of your screen. The ball goes way up in the air, and a nice route run by Bouvet, and it takes about three defenders. Jimmy Allen trying to rip the ball out at the end of the play, but the whistle is blowing in a big game.
Bouvet's first catch of this Mitchell Bowl. Down in Queens territory. And they're after him again. Oklahoma couldn't get to him. More pressure. They flush him out, and Gould just keeps it. And heads out of bounds down around the 30.
And you know what? I think Gruel's happy just to get to the sidelines in that play. It shows his athletic ability. He can move around the pocket, but I don't think he wanted to on this play. Little play action pass, and initially up the gut, there's Uquomo comes in, we're number 34, and then the rest of the team chases after. Pankwich has it shot. Bodies are flying around, and finally Jimmy Allen pushes him out of bounds, and we get a look at Uquomo Pankwich there. And that crew has really come to play.
Crew runs out of bounds for a gain of about a half yard. Second and long, Laval down by nine. Second half, Mitchell Bowl. End zone look. Oh, nearly a touchdown for Laval. In and out of the hands of Julian Fioli-Gudino.
And Fioli-Gudino, who won the MVP of the Vanier Cup last year, had an outstanding game, sure to come up with this football. He's much taller receiver than the defender, Jimmy Allen. You watch him play, he just runs a simple go route to the outside release. Allen's chasing with him, he fights back, nice to catch it. That's right through the mitts. I mean, rules have a tough time today. Try and connect him, he threw it right on the money. Should have been a catch.
Milo had one earlier of 35 yards. This one from 35, yes, and it is good. So Laval has something to show for it after that big play, that catch by Bouvette, putting three on the board and getting it back to within a touchdown now at 19-13, a six-point Queens lead.
Certainly an opportunity for Gould and Laval to put some more points on the board.
So back to within a touchdown. Milo keeping it a little closer for Laval. So we had a drop ball there. It could have been a touchdown. We had a drop ball the other way for Queens that could have sustained their drive and put them in scoring position. So a couple of key drops we've seen in the second half. Brannigan, the Queens 35 after that Laval field goal. Going off to his left. And the catch made there by number 8, Devin Sheehan.
That's a nice catch. It's sometimes hard to tell whether that's Devin Sheehan or Blaze Morrison as the ball gets out to his left in a hurry. Nice catch, nice throw, low and away. That time there was Blaze Morrison.
It is Morrison.
It's very difficult to tell those numbers scrunched together.
Sorry, Blaine, Devin, getting you guys mixed up with that 6 and 8. Got to do an appointment, switch your jerseys a bit, make it easier on us up here. Running that time left side. And a push down for the Gales, sustaining this drive. That time it is Marty Gordon, the running back.
Yeah, they go to the left-hand side of that line, followed by DiCivita and Matthew O'Donnell. O'Donnell, the big 6'11", 308-pounder. DiCivita leaves a big hole. O'Donnell seals to the inside and big play for the first down.
He is a load. What a big man. Closest to you there, the left tackle O'Donnell. Protection was good. Thrown out of bounds by Brannigan as that Laval defense tries to stiffen now. A lot of talent on that defense, too. One of the top ones in the country, and the number one defense, I should say, in the CIS this year.
And look at the stats and what they've been able to do. You couldn't tell by what they're doing out there today, and Brannigan's had a, pretty much his way. A couple drop balls have haunted his numbers, but they're able to move the ball at pretty much at will against this Laval defense.
Allowing only 61 points. Think about that. 61 all season long. About 19 here, and what do we see? Danny Brannigan sacked for the first time in a while. It didn't happen last week. The first time today, Fortin. Marc-Antoine Fortin gets to Brannigan.
And this really is just a lot of big push against O'Donnell. Fortin right across from him. And he does a good job pushing him into the backfield, swimming underneath him and getting to Brannigan. That's just good speed work, keeping low against a nice tackle like O'Donnell with that big reach. He just kept the motor running and got to.
So Queens to punt now. Village from his 36. They keep coming. They're not missing by much. I wouldn't be shocked to see Laval block a punt in this game. Getting a lot of pressure. Up to the 40 on the return for Rieu and Laval with the ball at the Mitchell Bowl on TSN. We've talked about Danny Brannigan, but it's his backup, Justin Chapdelaine, who is the impetus for the question of the game brought to you by Blackberry. We wanted to know what his association with Laval was. Did you know? And it goes back 10 years. His father, Jacques Chapdelaine, now with the BC Lions, was the head coach of Laval for their first ever Vanier Cup title when they beat St. Mary's back in 1999. And Jacques Chapdelaine's old team going up against his son's team. And his son's team is leading right now by 6 points, Laval football. That's completed to Fioli Godinho on the play. A gain of about 5 yards for Laval.
They went back to the receiver screen to Godinho. Gained a couple on the play, close to 4 yards, and I think you're going to see Rule getting back to what he does best as they're lining up in a couple tight end sets, no backs in the backfield, and a six-set of receiver. He's going to start airing the football out.
Gain of 4. First catch of the day, by the way, for one of their top receivers, Fioli Godinho. We saw in the previous set of downs, he nearly had a touchdown. Couldn't hang on to it. They set up the screen. Taken there by Maxime Bellon. Getting outside on Williams. Big, hard hit close to midfield. And a first down for Laval.
That's a really nice play call by Laval. Taking advantage of all the pressure that Queen's defensive line is putting on him. And the way the screen is set up, and you'll see it on the left-hand side, is they allow, Bellon allows Cuomo to come in the backfield and then leaks out late as Shamari Williams and company tries to chase him down. Nice little dump pass for a big gain, and now trying to get that battle of field position. You hear some contact at the end back into Laval's field.
Up near midfield, Laval 52, past the midway point of the third quarter. Queens 19, Laval 13. Brew, pressure, sacked again. Brew is down. Second and long.
So that time there, they brought the house. All the backers lined up in the gaps. It was DePrado that got to the quarterback, to Gruel in the end, but they were bringing the house on this play, and there's just too many guys, not enough defenders to defend them. Leaper in there, Pankowicz, DePrado, the big sack.
Alex DePrado, fourth year linebacker from North Toronto Collegiate. Second and long. Drew. Lots of time. Fioli Godinho with his second catch, and this one is much bigger. It'll move the sticks into Queens territory at about the 45.
And we mentioned what Fioli Godinho did last year, and we'll take a look at what he does here, running against a really good defender in Jimmy Allen. He's going to come on a deep in route here, beats him on the inside release, sticks him, creates some good separation, makes a catch, and then after that, gains a good 7-8 yards, just hustling upfield. Jimmy Allen makes a tackle in the end, but a great play by Godinho.
First down, handing off this time, Levesque. Stuffed again, as he was the last time he tried to carry in the previous set of downs.
And you're looking at Pankowicz again. First-year player, had a big game last week against Western, and again here, he's firing all cylinders, getting underneath the block of Fournier, the fullback, and making Levesque pay.
Great part of Queen's future to have, and they're so full of fourth and fifth-year players, to have a first-year guy play like that, had a great game against the Mustangs last week in the Yates Cup. Good coverage, it's complete to Hedera, and he's still going. Another first down. Here comes Laval, down inside the 25.
And the man that made the touchdown catch earlier on for Laval comes up with a big play here. Hedera comes across the middle. You know, Gruel's trying to hit, must see something that the Queens defense is giving up, and Vickers on the left-hand side of your screen from his safety position is going to come downhill and try and make a play, and you know what? Just didn't get either the contact on Hedera or the arms in front to knock it away with a big play at the Laval.
Seydou Jr. Hedera, another freshman. Oh, pressure, and down he goes. Hit hard, Chris Smith. Brew is sacked again.
And you have to give credit here to Pat Tracy, the defensive coordinator for Queens. He is pulling out all the stops, and his timing couldn't have been more impeccable. If you look right here on the top of your screen, watch him come scot-free. Chris Smith, beeline, nice tackle, great sack.
from the blind side. Grew had no chance on that. Second and 15. Looks left. Nobody there. A blown assignment. A receiver he expected to be in that from the left towards the goal line. Not there at all. It just falls incomplete, and it's third down.
Yeah, looked like Rule was trying to go to Hedera, who cut his route off to the inside instead of going down the sideline. And, boy, you're seeing that bit of uneasiness on that Laval sideline. There's some pressure on him right now to come up with a victory.
As the host team, the Vanier Cup, for the first time at Stade du Peps next week. And despite everything Laval has done, five championships in 10 years, my goodness, you know how badly they must want this one. The chance to host it, and the field goal attempt by Milo goes wide, and Jimmy Allen takes it out and has a good return going. Jimmy Allen could be gone. Yes, he is. 25-10-5, touchdown Gales. A missed field goal return by fifth-year Jimmy Allen, who had four returns, punts and kicks combined for touchdowns to lead the CIS, none bigger than the one he just came up with now. Village converts, 26-13 Queens.
And this is an absolutely huge play. Whenever you attempt a long field goal, more often than not, you got the big Hoggies, you got the offensive linemen out there trying to run down and make plays on a returner. No offensive lineman is going to tackle Jimmy Allen. But what happens better than that is Queens hustle back to set up the blocking. Vickers there, a whole bunch of guys leading the way up front. And the rest of it is Allen, last-ditch attempt to make it a tackle, and it's all for naught. This crowd got very excited in a hurry. You take a look at real speed. He can run. Jimmy Allen's not a huge guy. But you can hear the crowd in the background erupt. 4-10 makes a valiant effort as a defensive lineman to make a tackle, but the rest is history.
From Quinty Secondary School in Belleville nearby, call it a 120-yard return deep in the end zone after the missed attempt by Christopher Milo. Facing as any fifth-year player is their final game of collegiate football. And Jimmy Allen is making a case to have one more game with a return like that.
Really a look, a return of 120 yards in the Mitchell Bowl deserves a few replays. And here's another one here, and really, the blocking is set up through the hustle of the field goal return unit. You have your long return unit setting up the blocking for 10 again. Great effort by a big defensive lineman. Jimmy Allen.
What a momentum swing. What could have been a three-point game is instead a 13-point lead for the Gales. A 10-point swing on one play. The miss by Milo and the dramatic return by Jimmy Allen. Queens leading it, with time getting closer to quarter time here in the third, 1:41 on the clock, 26-13. The Gales have not been to a Vanier Cup since 1992. Lots of football yet to be played as Prudhomme pulls out a bag of tricks here by throwing it back. And a fumble, and Queens, I believe, has it. They do.
You know what? There's a scrum there to find out who comes up and down the bottom. And it looks like Laval does, but that ball was already down and collected.
There was an official indication that it is Queen's ball. And there it is. Brannigan of the offense coming back on.
And what happens here? Laval tries to set up a a bit of a trick play. They're going to take the ball, throw it here, throw it back, and then try a bit of an option. So Picard has the option to pitch it. He's holding it like a loaf of bread. In comes a nice stick. I think it was Vickers that actually knocked the ball to the ground, recovered by Queens, and what a huge turn of momentum.
And a chance to take complete command of this Mitchell Bowl now, working with a 13-point lead as Brannigan. Throwing off to his right for Surya. Has it. Down inside the 35.
There's the man that comes up to it with the fumble, Andrew Kerr. Initially, the kickoff is taken. The throwback happens, and then it's Picard's choice of whether to option it off. Well, the ball's hanging out there, and it's actually DePrato that knocks the ball away. And a nice recovery by Andrew Kerr in his first year playing in the Mitchell Bowl. Quite a thrill.
And an offside call against Queens. They signal that again. Offside Queens. Pushed back to first and 15 after the reception by Surya is negated. 1:04 on the clock until three-quarter time. Gales growing more and more confident in this game. Although for the second time in this half, in this third quarter, Danny Brannigan is sacked.
And let's take a look at that fumble again and what exactly happened with Picard. It seems he takes his eye off the ball at the end, looking to pitch right there. And there's the strip by DePrato. And a nice recovery by Kerr. He was looking to do a little too much on that play, and the ball pops loose.
Far be it for me to criticize a coach as great as Glenn Constantine, but 13 points down before three-quarter time, is it a bit early to be trying something like that? Easier to question after the disaster, of course. Looks to be completed down inside the 25. Did he catch it? That is Devin Shea, and hit the ball, and they call it a catch. The 23.
It's a nice catch. It may be a tad out of bounds. All you need is 1 foot in. It's going to be the right-hand side of your screen. He juggles it initially right there. That shouldn't be a catch. Didn't have possession of the football. As you see, it hits the top of his helmet. Stops rotation, actually, and then pops loose. That's not a catch.
So a good break for Queens there. As quarter time winds down, a first down inside the 25, pressing for more points. Up by 13. The handoff to Jimmy Therrien is going nowhere. He loses a yard. No time left in the clock, although that was the same story at the end of the first when we thought it was quarter time. And yes, they do announce it is the end of the third quarter. 15 minutes to play. Queens in good position now to move on to the Vanier Cup. We'll find out when we come back. Heading to the fourth quarter of the Mitchell Bowl. Advantage on the scoreboard for the Gales. And Mike, advantage with the stats too. And the one you don't see, of course, is that big kick return, the missed field goal.
Yeah, you took the words out of my mouth. That Laval's a time of possession go in their favor. The six sacks really still leading the way. And that pressure from that Queens defense hasn't let up.
Stats of the quarter brought to you by Mitsubishi, proud partner of the CIS. Queens in Laval territory, the 25 to start. An end zone look. And a touchdown for the Gales. 22 yards. Surya making amends for some earlier drops with another major for Queens as they pad their lead.
You got to give credit to Surya to come back. He's going to get the ball thrown his way again. He has a huge touchdown catch. Brannigan throws a sweet ball over top the Laval defenders. I don't think they appreciate the arm strength of a Danny Brannigan, because that's about as good thrown ball as possible. It drops in right over top. Samuel Lejoie, he's had a few go his way and not in his favor.
Village with the conversion. A 20-point lead. The Gales are now opening it up. They can sense it. This crowd certainly can.
You know, it's just It's been one of those days on offense and defense for Queens, and a nice play here from Brannigan on the left-hand side of your screen. Surya's going to run just a simple go route. Lajoie underestimates the arm strength. Nice catch by Surya as we take another look in the backfield. Good protection again by the big boys up front. They've been doing it all game long.
Brannigan's another fifth-year player concerned that this could be his final game of football. And also making a statement, like Jimmy Allen in the big return, that no, I think we'd like to play another one next week. That, of course, remains to be seen. Still over 14 minutes left, but opening up the 20-point lead. All momentum is on the side of the home team now, and I have to wonder what's going through Laval's collective minds now as they had so much hope to host that Vanier Cup in Stade de Peps next week. Not over yet, but they have a lot of work to do now against a defense that has pretty much confounded them with a few exceptions in this game. Ryu, a good return. This could help switch momentum back. Ryu gets it out closer to midfield. A good place to start.
Take a look at Rule as he comes back on the field, and Coach Constantine on the sideline. There used to be an up on teams. They're used to having huge leads. Actually, Rule is very rarely finishes a game. They're up so much, but now they got to play catch up, and this is probably the biggest drive of the game right now.
They won the Vanier Cup last year. They won it in 06, in 04, and 03, all under Glenn Constantine. That's a big play. Laval down inside the 15. On the receiving end is Matthew Bouvet from Benoit Gruel.
Well, Bouvet does a nice job getting inside technique on David Rooney. He just runs a simple seam route. It's going to come right down this hash mark here. The ball goes up in the air. Shaley gets inside technique, almost splitting the uprights, and Rooney's got to play catch-up. Nicely thrown ball by Gruel.
45-yard pass, Benoit Gruel. Mathieu Bouvet get a couple of big ones in this game. They need more. Time becomes the enemy at this stage of the game for Gruel. Laval, end zone look, too far. Second down. To follow up on the Laval story, 2 years ago, looking as defending champion, they went on the road for the bowl game in the UTEC Bowl, took on St. Mary's, and they lost. And they had said they'd learned their lesson because they had such a great regular season, as they always do, not to get too far ahead of themselves. Not suggesting that's happening today. They're playing a very good football team. But it was definitely on their minds not to take this game lightly. Remarkable coach, successful Glenn Constantine, 4 national titles. Trying to get back to a 5th. His team needs points. 4th quarter, 2nd down. Dumping it off, Maxime Bellon loses some footing. Tried to cut, couldn't do it. He's taken down at around the 11, and it's a field goal situation. What do you do now? 13 and a half minutes on the clock. You're down by 20.
Yeah, I think you definitely keep the offense on the field, and Gruel staying out there with the rest of the guys, his teammates. And that was a play there that Gruel had to get rid of the ball quicker than what he had to, and they're getting right to the line of scrimmage right now.
A great game by Queens defense could become much greater now. Third down. Laval needs 7 yards. And they get it and more. Bellon diving into the end zone for a Laval touchdown.
You know, that was a nice play by Hedera. He runs a seam route from the inside receiver to the right-hand side of your screen and pulls all the defenders with him. Leaves Bellon out there. You see the cornerback jump inside, and Jimmy Allen got caught looking at the seam route, and Bellon comes and catches the flat route in for the touchdown.
Exactly what Laval needed at this point in time with the conversion, getting it back to a 13-point game. And 12:55 on the clock. Lots of time. It's a 2-score game, thanks to this one by Bellon at the Mitchell Bowl. Laval's offense did its part. starting the comeback with a touchdown drive. Now they desperately need their defense to do its part as well. Queens is about to get the ball after a Laval touchdown to close this Mitchell Bowl back to a 13-point game in the fourth quarter, 12:55 to go. It was critical that Laval get in the end zone, and they did, going for it on third down. The most points Laval has given up this season. The previous was 28 against Montreal, and their only loss of the season. 33 on the board for Queens. Milo kicking off. They fake a reverse on the return. It's Jimmy Terry back there, and he gets popped very solidly by Frederick Plessius.
You know, Rod, that defense comes onto the field right now as the special teams goes off, and they're the number one defense in the whole country. They certainly have to come playing like they are today. We've let some things lapse, but the offense did its part, like you mentioned, and now huge time for that number one ranked defense to kick its heels in the ground and stop this potent offense.
Laval overall gave up only 61 points in the regular season. They've given up more than half of them. In this game today, of course, the biggest coming in a special teams touchdown off a missed field goal. Brannigan passing, and he has Valberg, but he's too far. He had Scott Valberg wide open across midfield.
And we'll take a look at Valberg and what he's done. And Lajoie is the defender on this play again. He's going to run a hitch and go, and he's going to catch Lajoie sleeping. Little out and up, inside move, and you know what? You cannot, as a defender, bite on those routes. But he did. Lucky that didn't go to the house.
So Laval catches a break there. Second down. Clock running. 12:19. With time to the right. Caught by Surya, just shy of a first down. It'll be close.
Very nice body control by Surya to catch a rocket that came out of the hands of Danny Brannigan, and it's going to be very close. That's about as good of a spot you can get with the linesman right there on the sideline with the sticks. And it looks like it's about a yard and change short.
Would you gamble in this situation?
This is, wow.
This is an interesting call. They are going for it. Now's the time for Laval's D. What a change in momentum this would be. A third down gamble by Queens, leading by 13. Oh, they have it. The gamble pays off, and they'll start killing more clock as they get the first down up at the 35. Marty Gordon, on a gutsy call by Pat Sheehan, picks up the first down.
The gutsy call is right. That was seriously sleepless nights if that didn't work out. And watch the offensive line. Biederman cracks down. Corbin leads the way on a nice block by the fullback number 13 and creates that seam for Marty Gordon to sneak through for the first down.
Keeping it on the ground, watching the clock tick down towards the 11-minute mark. Gordon again. 5 yards. Well, we're talking earlier about Sunday Night Football and Bill Belichick getting raked over the coals for that with the lead, a 6-point lead, and that failed. A call, but I guess you're brilliant when you make them, and you're not so brilliant when you don't, right? The life of a head coach.
That's true, and it's years of experience of being in those positions that allows you to make what you think are educated decisions, and certainly made a really good one there.
Even if it doesn't result in a score, the difference in terms of time of possession is huge at this point of the game. Brannigan looking left, a little bit too far there for Blaze Morrison. Pat Sheehan has been to this stage before. I remember him back as a head coach in Concordia. He was a player with Concordia before he joined Charlie Bailey as an assistant at McGill, won a Vanier Cup with Michael Soles in 1987 as an assistant. He moved on to Concordia, went to the Vanier Cup, won his bowl game in 98, and had a heartbreaking loss against the University of Saskatchewan on a toss play that went bad down near the end zone. Saskatchewan recovered. They won it by 7. He's... And all this, the work that he has done as Ryu has his return. All the great work that Pat Sheahan has done, and a flag comes down with a late hit.
It's going to be Shamari Williams chasing him down on the punt cover team. He really is all over the field, and I think what happens is it's a clean tackle, but it's about a yard out of bounds as he's hustling like mad. Ryu is going to take it and try and turn the corner, but nice pressure. Oh, it's the horse collar tackle, probably more than anything. Grabbing the jersey and the shoulder pads behind the neck. You're going to get called on that every time. It's for the safety of the offensive player.
Shamari Williams up too high there, and Guillaume Ryu on the punt return and a penalty.
It's where the right arm hooks the shoulder pads, and you can see how he goes down awkwardly. They try and limit those injuries from doing that.
Down near the 10-minute mark. Laval. Drove for a touchdown last time. They need to do it again. Mathieu Bouvet on the reception and picks up about 5-6 yards on the play.
And down by 13, it's a two-score football game now with just under 10 minutes left to go. There is a bit of urgency for Laval to get the ball into the end zone, but they can still take their time and move it methodical with, you know, in Canadian football, as we know, there's a ton of time left on the clock.
It is a two-possession game. Time enough to get it away, looking for Picard, and they say he caught it. He did get it. A big completion for Laval from Gru to Picard down at the Queen's 25.
It's a nice throw by Gru, who takes a chance throwing a long pass on a corner route to Picard. There's some discussion now. We get a chance to see on the left hand side here. David Rooney comes in at the end. It almost strips the ball away. Definitely, well, it's tough to see at the very end if the ball popped out, and we'll get a better look at it here. Initial catch, it's when he brings it in. I'd say that's a catch. And the catch is going to stand.
It does stand. After the game, there was a late flag on Laval, pushing them back to the Queen's 35. Nonetheless, first and 10. Can they drive for another touchdown and really make this a game? Looking for it, and too far for Bouvet. A look into the end zone, and he had him open, but just too much on the ball.
Yeah, Bouvet's running against DePrato here, and both teams are running these inside seam routes by the slot backs because there's no safety in the middle of the field. Left-hand side of your screen, you're going to come see Bouvet flash in front of you. The ball's just a tad overthrown as DePrato was playing catch-up on the play.
It's a second and 10. Ryu comes out of the game. 9:05 and counted. 33-20. Queens leading in the Mitchell Bowl for the right to go on to Laval and the Vanier Cup next week. Flag down on the snap. Over the middle. And it's completed. Caught there by Bruno Prudhomme. And what would be a first down pending the outcome of that flag.
I'm thinking it's going to be offside on Gudino, who really hit the line of scrimmage just flying. And it is. He's playing wide out. And he attacked that line like that ball was coming to him, which it didn't. But and we'll take a look here at which receiver it was. Pedera's at the top of your screen, who's in motion. And you know what? He's already in front before the snap of the ball. And certainly he, I don't know if the flag came from that side, but Pedera was definitely offside as well.
He was running into Queen's players as the ball was snapped. Pedera flagged and that offside. Second down and 15 now, 8:36 to go. Taking to Ballon with time. He wanted to dump it off there, but instead Gruel keeps it and gets a decent gain for a quarterback not known for running the ball. About 7 yards of it back, but it is decision time again for Glenn Constantine.
And there was initial pressure upfield by Ukwuoma and the boys, and getting into the backfield, Ukwuoma gets flattened on his back initially, but gets up again as Pankowicz comes around the end, and Ukwuoma chases him down. Shamari Williams finishes him Gruel off on the ground, but there's really some good coverage in the defensive backfield by Queens that is made Rule second guess what he wants to do.
There's an injured player on the field. It is third down.
place. Osu, the Cuomo, there's all the threes are throwing me off, and sometimes when you land on top of somebody, you get winded. It looks like he's going to be okay.
So for the second time this quarter, Laval is going for it on third down. 33-20. And a timeout is called by Queens. Making them think about it that much more. A two-possession game, Mike, if you've decided it's touchdowns or bust, or at this stage of the game, I guess you can't really think in terms of a field goal because you'd still need two scores after that. Time is running out.
Yeah, with a 13-point differential, you got to put two majors on the board and follow them up with some converts as well. But, you know, you dig yourself a hole if you're Laval, and you're forced to go for it when you don't necessarily want to, but you have to. The way Queens has played on defense, it makes it a little bit more difficult. As you watch Glenn Constantine on the sideline saying, I haven't had to have this situation too often.
A little bit different. A little bit different for Glenn Constantine. Laval. The crowd is really into it here, as you can see. Richardson Stadium coming alive at a big third down. They need seven. Last time in this situation, they got a touchdown. Here we go. Throwing, completing. And it is enough for a first down again, so they're two for two in third down conversions.
That time, Queens rushed forward, tried to get some pressure on Gruel. As you see the linebacker coming off the left-hand side and drop the other backers back and give a big opening. Picard comes in front of Chris Smith to make a big catch.
That's you, Picard, with
Let's
another
big catch.
Fourth-year student.
Cover down, cover down.
12-yard gain. Ball at the 20. Drive continues. Pressure's there. He gets it away. End zone. No. Close, but no for Laval. And it looks like the intended receiver is injured on the play. Matthew Bouvet.
It was a valiant effort by Bouvet as he ran a very, very nice corner route on the right-hand side of the screen. You'll see the tail end of him coming out of the corner. Nice separation. Catches it. Drops it. Lands on the ground and sure to be winded. He gets his fingertips on it and really would have been an outstanding catch had he brought it in. And the way he landed, as Matt Vickers is in chase mode and really just hoping what happened happened.
Bet you that made Pat Sheahan gulp a little bit. That close to being narrowed to a 6-point game.
Take a look at Gruel.
Oh, thought he had it.
It's an outstanding throw to put it in that spot as well.
Tension builds again. 7:44 in the clock. Second and 10, Laval, down by 13. Over the middle, complete, inside the five. Guillaume Rioux, it'll be first and goal Laval, and they still have plenty of time.
And really, this offense for Laval in the second half, at the left-hand side of your screen, you're gonna see Rioux come in the middle of the field. They're finding those intermediate routes in the open area. And they're really settling down and scoring some big yardage.
What a finish we could have at this Mitchell Bowl if Laval can punch it in. First and goal, the pressure's coming. They flush Gruel and they get it. Down goes Gruel at the 10. The sack. Who else? Shamari Williams.
Take a look at Shamari Williams, and I think the initial pressure from Stephen Laporte, the second-year man who gets in there in a hurry. Number 45, I'm going to take a chance that that's him there. And look at him, sprinting right through the different, right through the defense. And the whole way, Shamari Williams is getting held and still gets to Gruel, throws him to the ground.
Third sack of the day, Williams, seventh for Queens defense.
He is doing a number on Fisette today, the tackle for Laval, and really making it dangerous for Gruel to drop back and pass anytime.
7-2 for Queens. That pressure up front defensively is as big a story as any we have today. Queens teams he's managed on. Benoit Groulx, the Heck Crichton Trophy winner last year and a nominee once again in 2009.
If anybody has ever witnessed Queens play, you know that they have a good defense and they have an outstanding offense. The offense gets a lot of the praise, but when the defense had to come up big last week, they did. Today, they've come up huge as well, and really, Rules had that O-line in front of them for years that had given them the protection. It's broken down today, and they showed the little tweaks in the armor and the kinks.
Queens defense is having its best day of the season in the sack department. They had five against Ottawa U in the regular season. That had been their best. Seven today. Three from Williams. That one makes it second and goal. Laval needs a touchdown. Two cracks at it. There's one. Very close. No. Just a little bit behind him and low. Falling down for Ryu.
They're trying to utilize Ryu a little bit more on the offense and get him in some coverage this time against Rooney. Right-hand side of your screen. Look at the middle of the field. The ball is thrown nicely low and away. Rooney comes over just enough to disrupt it. We'll get a better look at it in slow motion. Ryu goes low for it, but when he comes back up, the ball's knocked away by Rooney.
They've gone to the well twice before. They're 2 for 2 in third down conversions. This is third and goal. Can they do it again? They've got to get in the end zone. Looking that way to the left. Up and down. No. Incomplete. Intended for Adair. And Queens D makes it stand, preserving the 13-point lead in the Mitchell Bowl in the fourth quarter. There's Ben Dandria, who had, to this point, the biggest play. There have been so many today, but on the third down stand on the coverage here on Adara.
Watch his right hand of Dandria at the very end knock this ball away. Very, very good coverage.
Ben Dandria wants something that makes me feel old. I played with his dad here at Queens back in 79. Jim Dandria, and from Calgary now, was a defensive back who also wore number 26, like father, like son.
You're going to get a good long look here of Terrian and Marty Gordon trying to keep the ball on the ground, keep the clock rolling. Just over 6 minutes left in the football game, a 13-point game in favor of Queens. At a second and long here, and Laval defense has to come up big to get this ball back in their offense's hands.
6:07 on that clock here in the fourth quarter. It's a little darker here at Richardson Stadium coming up after this game. We'll find out who the winner of this game will play in the UTEC Bowl between University of Calgary Dinos and the St. Mary's Huskies. They were both in the national semis last year. In fact, the only team that wasn't in the semis last year was Queens. It was Western instead. Calgary lost to Laval. Western beat St. Mary's, and then Laval beat Western in Hamilton last year in the Vanier Cup. Queens is the newcomer. They're trying to get to that national championship game for the first time since 92, when they beat Guelph in the Churchill Bowl, and then they played St. Mary's in the Vanier Cup that year. And talk about good defense, Mike. Queens shut out the Huskies, a good Huskies team, 31-0. It was coached by Doug Hargraves back then, and they had the that's the only time in Vanier Cup history that there's been a shutout. So they're awfully very proud of their defense, and my old coach actually isn't sitting too far away from us. Comes to every game. Doug Hargraves, a great head coach. One of the legends of this program, Frank Tindall, he took over for the great Frank Tindall, for whom the Coach of the Year trophy is named, from 1976 up to 1994. He won two national titles in 78, and again that one in 92. Can Queens make it back? They're getting closer. Incomplete there from Brannigan. 6:06, still on the clock, and still time for Laval, down by 13.
That was a bit of a tight throw for Brannigan, trying to thread the needle in between Supernaw and Noel. Noel's coming to the game for Letourneau, and I don't know if there's an injury to Letourneau or basically they weren't happy with the way he was playing on the corner. Noel's come in, number 24, to work that short field corner for Laval.
Mm-hmm. Village back standing at his goal line. He will concede the two. A 13-point game is reduced to 11. Excuse me, Jimmy Allen in there. No intention of kicking the ball. Instead of the punter, Village, and gives up the 2 points, as was done earlier by Laval, but it keeps it at an 11-point game, meaning it's still a two-score game.
Yeah, I think that's a really smart call by Coach Sheehan to give up the two. It's still, like you said, still a two-score game. And now Laval is going to scrimmage from the 35-yard line, or actually looks like Queens is going to kick off, pardon me, and give the ball back to Laval.
This is part one, deciding who will go to the Vanier Cup in Quebec City next week. Up next, the UTEC Bowl, St. Mary's and Calgary. And the big story there in Halifax, the return of Blake Nill, who won two national titles with the Huskies. Eric Glavich, former Heck Crichton Trophy winner, transfers from St. Mary's to Calgary, and they're coming back, facing Steve Samara. And St. Mary's, one of those two, will be off to the Vanier Cup to face the winner here. The UTEC Bowl is coming up next on TSN. Good day for Queens fans, the students in abundance on the east side here at Richardson Stadium, their traditional spot. Laval receives after that safety was given up by the Gales. Leung on the return gets it up to the 45. So it goes from a 13-point game down to 11, meaning those two scores could include a field goal if there was a touchdown and a two-point convert. I don't know if that would change the mindset now for Glenn Constantine, who's been going for it on third down.
Well, if anybody can put the drive together, it certainly is Brule, who's done it throughout his career. Look at his numbers today. Not bad at 330 yards. Certainly the second half has come alive.
5:26 left in the clock. Brule throwing, and they do a little hook and lateral. Big play to Maxime Ballon. Saw that work years ago in the NFL by the Miami Dolphins in a playoff game against San Diego. Little hook and lateral for Laval, and a big yardage for the Rouge Or.
And take a look at this play here. This is very strategic. Guys are biting inside. First of all, Hedera catches it, and then Ballon takes it to the outside of the pitch. He's got speed to burn. If not for a saving tackle pushout, I think it was Chris Smith that came over. Take a look at number 80. Hedera runs a little comeback hook route, and the quick pitch as Jimmy Allen jumps inside. Ballon takes it. I think Chris Smith has to come over to knock him out of bounds.
So Laval, not the first time today, Mike, that they've tried a little trickery. It backfired before on the kick return that they ended up fumbling, but this one paid off with a huge gain down inside the 30. As Ballon is attended to, Laval. He's had some big plays today. Big reception in the first half that led to Laval's first touchdown.
Offense obviously saw something that they can take advantage of, and it's a play that's not used too often. More often than not, it's used with like 10 seconds left in a football game, but very timely.
Hot Queens off guard, total of 36 yards gained. After Adair, pitch to Ballon. Laval is coming back, trying for more. 5:13, down by 11. On the run is Brule. Do they get to him? Yes, they do. Pankowicz, the freshman, chasing him down. And a flag on the play.
Yeah, and this one's coming back as well. This is going to be holding on the offensive line for Laval. They're going to push it back.
Okay.
The tenacity of that D-line getting into the backfield in a hurry and flushing out Brule and not letting him set up and take advantage of those gaudy stats he has for completion percentage. Take a look right here at the pressure that's given. That's Jamari Williams working against Fassett. Just keeps pushing, spins off, never gives up on the play. Pankowicz comes over to finish him off. But the guys are hustling down there.
Holding penalty makes it first and 20. It's pushed back to the 38 and a half. Queens. Laval needs at least a field goal. All along they've been thinking touchdown. Complete. That's caught down at the Queens 25 for close to first down yard. It's still a few yards shy. A pickup there by Fioli Godinho.
Yeah, Fioli Godinho runs a nice route. He runs the hook route. What happens is Jimmy Allen falls down. You'll see a nice iso here. Watch Allen at the top of the route. Tries to recover. Doesn't fall down, but stutter steps. Doesn't get his footing. Plays catch up. Godinho comes up with a nice catch.
In a 15, second and five. They pick that up. First down. Picard down inside the five. Or close to it. It'll be first and goal again for Laval. 4:07 on the clock. Touchdown or bust. They need it badly.
And this is a nice bit of play calling here. With Picard coming out and getting covered by Laporte. Laporte's not going to cover receiver. He comes from his Sam linebacker position. He has to chase Picard down, but not after a big gain.
Injured player on the field for Queens. Gives Laval a little bit more time and Glenn Constantine to consider what they are going to do now in another first and goal situation. The last time they had it, they got pushed back and they tried for the third time on third down and they didn't make it. The pass intended for Hedera, broken up by Ben Dandria in the end zone. And a good Laval contingent there today. They've been known, Mike, to travel well. Loving their football there, as you would certainly see if Laval was at the Vanier Cup at Stade du Peps next week. I don't know what the crowd would be like if they're not, and that's something that at least has to be considered at this point, although this game far from over. TJ Leeper heading off now.
Yeah, that's somebody you don't want to lose from your middle linebacker position, the team leader on defense. You want to get Leeper back into the football game, but the strength of this offense and the way they've been moving the ball down the field for chances to score on three straight possessions. None bigger than this right now.
If Laval gets in, we got a game. First and goal. Whistled down, flags in the play.
If I had to guess, I'm thinking Bouchard jumped from his left tackle position. He got out of his stance pretty early. Left tackle, take a look. There's Bouchard right there before the snap of the ball. There you go. Just enough. Takes a step back, and that snap was enough.
The fifth-year left tackle and the Quebec Conference nominee for the Metros Trophy. A great offensive line, that left tackle, but a costly penalty there to make it a little further back. Outside the 10 now. And that first and goal. Under 4 minutes on the clock. Concern over the clock. It reads 3:54, and Glenn Constantine, I believe, wants more time put back on the clock. Of course, at a premium right now for Laval. As the crowd at Richardson starts to get on his case.
I think he gets his wish as it goes back to 3:57.
You never know. Three seconds?
You never know.
It could be a lifetime in this game. Queens led by as many as 20 in this second half. That lead is down to 11. First and goal. Under pressure. End zone. Touchdown, Laval. We've got a game.
Godinho comes up with a nice touchdown catch at the best of times. Runs an in route from his slot back position. And Gruel under pressure. He's going to come from the left-hand side of your screen. He's going to come right into this area. Gruel falling down delivers a beautiful ball. And Jimmy Allen is just left in chase position. And now they're going for two.
They have to. If they get the two-point convert, they're within a field goal. Quick fake, tries to run it in. Benoit Groulx does. So Laval from 20 down gets it back to within three with 3:38 to go in the fourth quarter. What a Mitchell Bowl. You're watching on TSN. Don't go away. This is what they're playing for, the Mitchell Bowl, and a ticket to the Vanier Cup. That trophy named after, as you heard from him at the half, Doug Mitchell, the former CFL commissioner, who has done such a wonderful job spearheading the BLG Awards that recognizes great athletes in the CIS, has for years. And watching some great athletes in the CIS play this game today for that trophy. It is so close now. What was once a 20-point lead for Queens is down to three after a touchdown and a two-point convert by Laval. What a game. 33-30, 3:38 on the clock. The unity of Laval, not used to being challenged like this in such a key game. Trying to get home either way to go back to Quebec City, but they want to go back for a chance to play in another national title. There's a reverse by Queens on the return. They're going to be into the hands of Allen. Jimmy Allen, who had that big return, 120 yards on the missed field goal for the touchdown that blew this game open for a while, has a return there of 33.
Really, really well set up as well as Terrian pitches into Allen. That's a nice block and upfield. Gordon leading the way. What this does is provide instant field position for Queens in this late stage of the football game. You want to force Laval, if they have a chance at all, to drive the whole length of the field.
Brannigan in the offense still of the lead. Laval has all the momentum. Queens needs something to happen now. Protect it. Just a field goal advantage on the ground. Gordon, nowhere to go. Losing yards back near the 35.
And really, we talked a lot about the Queens defensive line, but it was the pressure up front by Laval and their front four that really led to this minimum gain at all, as the boys busted into the background. J.P. Gilbert, Bernier, Fortin, Cloutier. They need to come up big on this drive.
3 minutes exactly on the clock. They whistle it in. And a big 3 minutes for these schools to come. Brannigan out of shotgun, taking his time and dumping it out. Wide open there is Shayen, Devin Shayen. Near first down yardage, but not quite. Interesting decision coming up here. Pat Shayen went for it earlier in the quarter on third down. There's been a lot of third down gambling going on.
Taking it to the right-hand side as Shayen comes underneath again. The favorite route by the Queens offense is to run the under the package, and he almost gets there. He's about a yard and a half, and they're going for it again.
If they don't get it, Laval will be one first down away from tying the game in field goal range. That's how big this is. A third down gamble. Gordon gets it. The switch move. Queens still has the ball. Shayen is 2 for 2 in third down gamble.
That is a gutsy call. Because if you don't make it, you're putting yourself in a terrible position. Javita leads the way, seals the end just enough for Gordon to get the corner. Shayen knows.
My goodness.
Looks like, yeah, like he had it planned.
Glenn Constantine's third down gambles have been more understandable. Deep in the clean zone, needing touchdowns. Gordon. Again, left side, busts off about 4 or 5 yards, and yet Pat Shayen, confidence in that old line, confidence in the running backs, and 2 for 2 as mentioned. It's hard to question it when he's succeeding. And the crowd booing now, obviously doubting the sincerity of the injured Laval player right now, thinking they're just trying to buy some time.
Well, what it does is actually stop the clock now, whereas because it was a run play under 3 minutes, it would have been whistled in prior to the snap of the football.
take a look at the injured player right now, and it's Philippe Lemire. They'll try and keep an eye on how he got injured, or if he got injured. You hate to assume when a guy's down on the ground. You don't ever want to. You see one player down. That was earlier on, the old fake injury magically came back up.
Well, Lemire limps off. Crowd doesn't believe it. Think of how big that first down, that third down gamble was for Sheehan and the Gales to get it to 2 minutes, protecting that 3-point lead, venturing over into Laval territory. Such a critical point in this game. Such a big second down here now. Will Laval get the ball back? Queens trying to deny them, keeping it on the ground. It looks this time like Laval indeed will get it back. Unless Pat Sheehan's an even greater gambler than I thought. This is more than a yard or two. A good three anyway.
You would think it's this is a no-brainer. You bring on your punt team, which he is doing. Much to the thankfulness of the crowd.
Big chance here for Village to hem Laval deeper in. He'll be punting from around his 45. Neither punter has had a particularly strong day, however. Letting the clock run down as much as possible is Dan Village. Not a bad punt towards the sideline, and no choice at all for Guillaume Rioux. 1:19 on the clock, deep in their zone, 3 points down for the defending Vanier Cup champions. How long has it been for Queens? 1992, led by their great running back, Brad Elberg. Explosive against that St. Mary's defense, and it was the defense of Queens which also shone. The Queens Golden Gales dousing Doug Hargraves, who is here today. With the national championship in 1992, 31-0. Queens has not been back to the Vanier Cup since. They're 1:19 away. But what can Laval do to get into field goal range? Grew. Trying a deep ball. Has a man. It is caught near midfield. No, no good. It looked like he had it.
That's about as close as you're going to get to being a completed or incompleted ball. Gudino splits the defenders. Vickers being one of them, running the seam right-hand side of your screen. And comes up with a diving stab and can't reel it in at the end. A perfectly thrown football by Gru.
We have seen some drops today. That one is the biggest. He had an earlier one. Gudino. Would have been a touchdown. Back again, another deep one for Bellon. It is too far, and they're down to a different kind of third down gamble now. 1:07 on the clock. They're not deep in Queens territory this time. They're deep in their own, and they need at least 10 yards.
You know what? You really have to look at the play selection for Laval and why they're going downtown on every play. I understand the first play, you're trying to make a big hitter, but when it's second and 10 in your own end, and you're throwing a very low percentage pass. Now it sets them up for third down.
Third down. A trip to the Vanier Cup is on the line. Grohl complete right near the first down marker. It will be very close. It looks like they may just have it. It might be close enough to measure. It is a first down.
I'm Coach Sheehan. I'm asking for the measurement regardless because it's that close. But the sticks have moved and it's a first down extending this drive.
Mathieu Picard. Another third down gamble. Nothing but for Laval in this quarter. Under pressure. Drew. Flag down. Looks like holding against Laval and he throws it out of bounds.
And it is holding and this is a huge penalty, backing them up 10 yards, making it first and 20 in their own end. And you got to give credit to the defensive pressure of Shamari Williams and company and what they've done all day long to that offensive line. And Shamari Williams on the top left-hand side of your screen, and he is working, he said. Working.
Saw Pat Sheahan saying, yeah, we're taking that penalty. Push him back 10 more. 49.2 seconds on the clock. What a finish. Could this be it for Laval as champion? Trying to get back to repeat. Back home. They get him. They've got the ball. The Gaels have the ball. And they're going to the Vanier Cup. Osiakwoma strips Grew of the ball.
And what an absolutely fitting end to the display that this defensive line and linebacking crew has done all day long. And you got to throw the defensive backs in there as well for what they've done on coverage, getting the ball back with 41 seconds left. And what can you say?
The Gaels are 41 seconds away. Just kill the clock and advance to a national championship game. What a game it's been. What a fourth quarter charge by Laval that appears to have come up short.
Take a look at Pankowicz here, the first year player. He's the guy that gets the rule and he just works it. He is working against an all-Canadian of Bouchard, comes back, hustles, knocks the ball down. Bouchard picks it up. That's hustle. First year player, Mitchell Bowl, biggest play of the game so far.
Oh, Laval's won before, but they desperately wanted to host this game. They wanted to be there when it's played at Stade du Peps in Quebec City. Down it goes. Down to 18 seconds. Nothing they can do. Sheahan leading the charge. The cheers from the fans here at Richardson Stadium. The clock winds down. The Gaels had to beat Laval to get to Laval. And they've done it. Queen's University has advanced to the Vanier Cup for the first time in 17 years. Celebration for the Mitchell Bowl champion Queen's Golden Gaels. Victorious and heading off to the Vanier Cup. The first time they've been able to celebrate a bowl victory here at Richardson Stadium since 1983. Let's have a look at the TSN turning point. Mike, so many big plays. You can't imagine anything bigger than this.
No, at this point of the game, it was a five-point ball game, six-point ball game. Jimmy Allen takes it in his end zone. 120 yards later, the fifth-year senior from local Belleville takes it to the house, and not a bigger play to take him on to victory.
What could have been a three-point game turned out of a 13-point lead for Queens on that touchdown. The TSN Turning Point brought to you by Desjardins. Queens is partying, and Queens has spoiled Laval's party. They won't be hosting the Vanier Cup next week. The Gaels are going.
CIS Football on TSN is brought to you in part by Desjardins. The largest cooperative financial group in Canada is proud to support Canadian inter-university sport. By Mitsubishi Motors, makers of the best backed cars in the world. By Wilson, the only football on the field for all of the CFL and CIS teams. Wilson, number one in football. And by BlackBerry. Get the best phones on the best network, like the BlackBerry Bold 9700 Global Smartphone from Bell.
As Queens celebrates, this Mitchell Bowl, Mike, had a bit of everything. Sure, it had big plays on offense, and it definitely had big plays on special teams, but we have to go back to how well that defense played on the Gales.
Oh, the defense played outstanding. It really was the key to the game going into the contest, is how they could match up and get into the backfield and disrupt Gruel and get him off his game. They did that early and often.
Players don't want to head to the locker room anytime soon now. Enjoy this with friends and family. What a special moment it is. First time since 1992 that they're getting back to the national championship game. They've won three before in 68 under Frank Tindall, in 78 and 92 under Doug Hargraves. And now Pat Sheahan, in his 10th season as head coach at Queens, has taken this team to a national championship game. His second, he was with Concordia against Saskatchewan back 11 years ago, 98 at Skydome. This one to be played at Laval, and how heartbreaking the Rouge Or are, of course, wanting to play in that game and go for another title. But an OUA team back in the Vanier Cup for the second straight year, just like Western a year ago. Queens looking to take it a step further after, think of those tough games they had against the Mustangs. You were here, and in the last month they had, think of how close they were and how close it was for Western to get back.
Oh, they had some huge games. Three unbelievable finishes to big contests, and Queens came out on top of all of them. And you got to, talking about Coach Sheahan, think of the third down gambles he took today that really preserved this win. He took chances that most people wouldn't take, but he has confidence in his team.
I don't know about you. Top. I've watched a lot of football games in my lifetime. I've never seen so many third quarter gambles in one quarter. Sorry, third down gambles in one quarter than we have in this game. More understandable because Laval was so far behind that they were doing it. They were playing three down football. But you're right. Those gambles by Pat Sheahan were extraordinary.
They paid up. They certainly were extraordinary.
I was just going to say, they were ridiculous if they didn't win. It's nice to be able to second guess, with hindsight being 20-20, second guess a head coach, right?
You know, and I think the field had something to do with it as well. The hometown, having the crowd behind you, and they certainly rose to the occasion today. And those players, they played tough all year round. Last year, they go undefeated and lose in the playoffs and don't get a chance. Brannigan in his last year. How fitting is it that he gets a chance to go his only trip to the Vanier and play it?
He was worried, realistically. I mean, the plight of the Canadian quarterback in the CFL, that once this season is over, he will have played his last game. So obviously, you know, who wouldn't be thinking about that possibility, as confident as they might be coming into today, that this could be it? I mean, we saw it with Michael Faulds last week. Valiant as he was with his injured knee, saw his time come to an end in his university career anyway. And for Danny Brannigan, it goes on. He extends it one more week.
He does. And Danny Brannigan's going to be a champion no matter what happens in life. He's a great individual, highly regarded by his teammates and obviously his coaches. And, it may not be a future playing quarterback in the CFL, but there's definitely a bright future for Danny Brannigan.
Very poised today, as was Benoit Grue. I mean, the quarterbacks had some a tough situation. We were awaiting the presentation of that Mitchell Bowl, which stands alone as the celebration continues. And we want to show you what happens in the UTEC Bowl. It is Calgary and St. Mary's. Who will advance there in Halifax to take on Queens? The Gales moving on to Quebec City. We know they're in. Who's next? Let's have a look and throw it down to Halifax. The second part of our doubleheader is coming up here on TSN. Thanks for watching.
I got a camera right beside me. Do you see me? Okay. Okay. Yeah, hey, buddy. Don't worry.
I watched that.
All right, we're good. Anytime? Okay, here we go.
Well, Shamari, all the talk all week was about all the offense and what both quarterbacks can do, but the defense obviously stepped up, led by yourself. Well, what was the game plan coming in?
The game plan was just to put a lot of pressure on Gruel and stop Levesque. They're both great players, and we were able to execute that today.
And listen, I guess good thing your team got that big lead early on, but you guys made it happen. You got the sacks. You put a lot of pressure on him. You caught him out of his routine.
Yeah, all week long we heard about how great they were, so we really wanted to put them to the test this week. And they're a great team. They really are. But we were able to just put a lot of pressure on them, and that helped us a lot, helped the offense.
And so now you defeat the reigning Vanier Cup champs, and now you get to go to their house and try to win one back here for Kingston.
Yeah, definitely. It's good that we won. Now we've got to go to their house. Hopefully they treat us pretty good up there. But next week's going to be big for us. I believe we'll play Calgary, and they're a great team as well. So we got to get ready for that next week.
All right, listen, for a school that hasn't been to the Vanier Cup in 17 years, what do you think it means to the program here?
I think it's big for the program. I think it's big for the school, big for the community, and it's great. It's great to finally bring something back here. We worked really hard for it, and it's great. I think the school deserves it.
All right, man. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Right, thanks, man. Okay, where's Danny? How are you doing? Danny.
Danny.
Danny, yeah.
Amazing. Thanks a lot.
How are you, man? Okay, you good? Anytime? All right. Well, Danny, coming into the game, all the talk was about you and Benoit and what you guys could do in the air, and eventually did turn out that way, but your defense stepped up big today.
Yeah, our defense played excellent today, and also our special teams with the big touchdown. I think it was a good team win today.
So tell me about what it means for this school, this program, going back to the Vanier Cup for the first time in 17 years.
Yeah, obviously it means a lot, and this has been a goal for a lot of guys on the team. This is why you play university football right here.
Listen, during the game, I mean, you knew what you were up against, the Vanier Cup champs, reigning champs, and you knew that they wanted to take it back to their house and defend. What was the key to getting that early lead on them? And pretty much it took a little while, but once you got the ball moving, you were able to move the ball quite a bit.
Yeah, it took us a little while, but luckily our defense came out swinging right out of the gates, and they really kept us in the game, and that helped us out a lot.
So I know you only just won this game, but how much are you already excited about the fact you're going to the Vanier Cup?
Yeah, I mean, it hasn't sunk in yet, but very excited already. So.
All right, thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, guys.
We're good.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. All right. So I guess they're just going to do the actual presentation now. So we can all sit back and enjoy this.
I love Quebec City in November. I'd like to, first of all, congratulate the guys that had a great win this afternoon. I'd like to introduce Mark McGregor, the CEO and chairman of the CIS, and Mr. Doug Mitchell, who the bowl is named after. They're going to hand out the player of the game to Shamari Williams. And I'd like to call on the team captains to come up here. OC and Danny. Where's Danny? Where's Danny? Come on up and get your trophy, Danny. Ready? Congratulations on winning the 2009 Mitchell Bowl, guys.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name's Pat Shane. I'm Mitchell Bowl champion. First and foremost, I would like, on behalf of the football team, thank all the Queens students. Queens really showed up today. We would also like to thank... We would also like to thank all the Queens alumni and all of the fans from the Kingston and community here. You really turned up to support us. Thank you very much. And next week in Quebec City, we are going to the dance, everybody.